bespoke radio for the masses.
Headline edition, July 8, 1947. The Army Air Forces has announced that a flying disc has been found and is now in the possession of the Army.
If the game is rigged, change the game.
Game changer.
I occasionally think how quickly our differences worldwide would vanish if we were facing an alien threat from outside this world.
This is Fade to Black with your host, Jimmy Church, on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
I need your help to get to the year 1985.
Listening to Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Network.
All right, welcome, welcome. Fade to Black. Bespoke radio for the masses. Today is Tuesday, November 10th. 314 days into the new year, just 51 days left. For KJCR and the Game Changer Network and KGRA The Planet, I am your oh-so-humble host, Jimmy Church. I would like to welcome everybody listening all around the world, all across the United States, hither and thither, to and fro, back and forth, up and down, east and west, north and south, far and near. We are live from Burbank, California. And tonight, we have very special guest Tracy Twyman. She'll be discussing her latest article. It is called Found Again, The Templar Artifacts of Hammer Purgstall. You can read the article. We posted it today. You can read the article over at her website, Tracy Twyman. And she has a new book coming out. It will be released, I believe, this Friday. It is called Baphomet, The Mystery of Mysteries Unveiled. Pop out the book cover here shortly. We'll fire that off into Twitter. The call-in number tonight is 323-825-5045. You can also Skype in Fade to Black 14. Tomorrow night, we have right here Michael Cremo, Forbidden Archaeology. Tomorrow night, Michael Cremo. And don't forget, Q&A week is coming up in just two short weeks, November 30th through December 3rd, with on Monday, November 30th, Von Setian will be here. Tuesday, Michael Lee Hill. Wednesday, Leo Zagami. Live from Rome. And then Thursday, some guy named Jimmy Church. And it's our own version of the AMAs. And we're going to do it right here on Fade to Black. We're doing it because we've had, especially with these three guests, three shows where the shows were just so jam-packed with conversation that we didn't take phone calls that night. And so that's what we're going to do. We're going to open it up to you that week. Q&A week, November 30th through December 3rd. I do want to remind everybody about Alien Snowfest. They've extended through the month of November the super early bird special of $179. They're doing it just for you fader knots. Just go to aliensnowfest.com and there you go. Everything is there. That is February 5th through the 7th. Again, coming up very quickly. 2016 up in Big Bear, California. And that Snowfest will be attended by George Norrie, Tom Danheiser, Jason Martell, Linda Moulton Howe, Stanton Friedman, Micah Hanks, Mike Barrett, Chase Kletsky, Craig Campobasso, Marshall Klarfeld, Richard Dolan, and myself. And right now, the full passes are $179 through the month of November. Just go to aliensnowfest.com. If you go over to the website, jimmychurchradio.com, it's right there. Just click and get over. All of your information, lodging, everything that you need, restaurants, everything is right there at aliensnowfest.com. Oh. Over, if you're on the website right now, you can see a video. It's a mon. Just go check it out. It's a video that was shot out in the Salton Sea, which is east of Los Angeles out here. And I've reached out to the person that shot the video. It's a compilation of time-lapse photography that was taken that night. And we didn't know once we got a hold of the video. And by the way, there was, you know, Facebook does not want those images posted. It is bizarre. Got email today from somebody that was trying to post it too as well. Couldn't get it posted. We ended up getting it posted, but we had to do it through a backdoor kind of setup. And we eventually got the video posted, but it is there. And what it shows now, and this is what's strange about the video. I want you to go and see it. And let me know what you think. All of the photography and videos, not only, you know, out of San Francisco, but here in Los Angeles and San Diego. And I've seen some stuff out of a friend of mine, Larry Dolan, posted too, out of Las Vegas. And out of I have not seen this explosion that was shot out in the Salton Sea. And it clearly shows something. And you have to go and see it. So go look at the video at jimmychurchradio.com. It's incredible. I don't know what to make of it. So anyway, the photographer, once we found out who she was, I went and listened to an interview that she did. I've reached out to her. I want to bring her on the show and talk to her about what she saw out there and how she put this together. It's pretty amazing. So she had cameras that were set up on tripods. They were out there shooting other stuff. And they happened to capture this. So they took the time-lapse photography images and put it together for that animated GIF that you see at JimmyChurchRadio.com. Pretty amazing stuff. So there you go. I haven't seen this explosion anywhere else. Nobody else talked about it. And why was it just seen by her? I don't know how to explain it. I don't. But go and check it out. It's absolutely amazing. Rita just posted links to it. Let me go ahead and retweet this now, because if you're not on the website, then you can't, if you're not listening to us right now at JimmyChurchRadio.com, but I can't get this to retweet, Rita. Very strange. Why won't it retweet? Huh? Man. Technology sometimes just messes with my head, and I can't get that to retweet. I don't know what it is about the internet and this missile test and posting images of it and why it's getting choked down all over the place. It's pretty interesting. They go and they do the missile test off the coast in front of millions of people, but they don't want us to repost video. The images, I don't know. I don't know what's going on with it. Been having problems with it now for 2 days. All right. Conscious Life Expo is February 19th through the 22nd. And information on that is at consciouslifeexpo.com. That is going to be a great weekend too as well. We're going to broadcast live that Saturday night. And there you go. I got an email about Grace and the Grace digital radio players that this show isn't broadcasting on Grace anymore. And I don't understand what that is about, but we're going to look into that. And there you go. So let's get the show cracking. We got a lot to do tonight. Tracy Twyman is up now. Before I get to, you know what? No, I'll discuss that in just a second. I was going to talk about Tracy's new article. It's absolutely It was so good that after I read it, a few things happened right in a row. Boom. I had to get her on the show tonight to talk specifically about the new Baphomet book and this Knights Templar casket discovery in a museum. We'll get to all of that. But when I was reading the article, and I was just like, this is exactly when I want somebody researching, when I go and I take the time and I invest into something, I want to get something out of it. That article and this book is revealing. And the research is done, and it's incredible. And tonight you're going to hear about this for the first time. I posted the article today because I wanted everybody to understand and get a better grasp of what we're talking about tonight, because it is so deep is the word. It's deep. It's very deep. And there's something going on here. So tonight I'm excited about Tracy being here. So let's get the show cracking. Today, comedian Tracy Morgan is 47 years old. Mackenzie Phillips, remember her? Mackenzie Phillips, 56 years old. Remember, she was in American Graffiti when she was like 12 years old. Very disturbing part that she played in that. But she was also in One Day at a Time with Valerie Bertinelli. And what was the mom's name? Who played the mom on One Day at a Time? I'm brain freezing right now. I'll remember it here in a second. Also today, Greg Lake of Emerson, Lake & Palmer is 68. Sinbad is 59. Sinbad will always make the list because of House Guest. That movie was great. That is all. Ex-GNR guitarist DJ Ashba is 43. And DJ, you know, you're a good player and all that stuff, but I think you're going to learn a lesson. Never quit GNR. Don't do it. It's a career killer. Never quit GNR. Yeah, the best thing you can do is stay in that band. That's all I got to say. DJ Ashba, 43, lives right here down the street from the studio in Encino. Our dead guy's birthday today, got a few. Richard Burton, Brittany Murphy, happy birthday, and Roy Scheider. Roy Scheider, 1932 to 2008, died at the age of 75. One of the all-time greats, one of my all-time favorites, period, end of story, who played, of course, Police Chief Martin Brody in Jaws, starred as Joe Gideon in All That Jazz. It's showtime. Fosse, Fosse, Fosse. Do you get that joke? And he played Detective Claudio Russo in The French Connection. Three of the great movies ever, right there. But he also starred in Blue Thunder. Good movie. 52 Pickup. He was in Naked Lunch. How about Romeo is Bleeding? That was a good movie. Executive Target. He was in The Rainmaker. He was in Chain of Command. But my sleeper pick is 2010. That's right. He played Dr. Haywood Floyd. I liked, by the way, 2010. I'll go on the record right now. Was it 2001? No. Was it a great movie? Yes. In 2004, Scheider was found to have multiple myeloma, and he received a bone marrow transplant to treat the cancer in June 2005. He died on February 10th, 2008, in Little Rock, Arkansas, at the University of Arkansas's Medical Sciences Hospital. And that's why I'm going to go right here on Twitter. I'm going to do it right now. What was Scheider's best film? What was it? What was Scheider's best film? Because when you have, you know, The French Connection, Jaws, and All That Jazz in your back pocket, that's a tough call. And of course, it's going to be Jaws, right? I'm saying not so fast. This is Fade to Black. Tonight, Tracy Twyman is here. She's in the batter's box. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. When I come back, all of the news that you know nothing about. I'll be back right after this.
You're listening to Jimmy Church, Fade to Black.
Fade to Black will now pause for alien identification.
The station that talks the net. KGRA Radio.
What's up, revolutionaries? It's me, Jimmy Church. Do you have an IRS or state tax issue? Well, I did, and I called national tax experts. My problems were fixed, done, fini, and man, I gotta tell you, it was a relief. National tax experts are a recognized tax office that services clients in all 50 states. Doesn't matter where you live. Give them a call. I'm telling you, they take the time to understand each and every client's individual financial status as well as their financial goals. And that's exactly what you need, my brother, when you're taking on the evil three-letter. So, seriously, give them a call today at 1-877-909-5444. Again, 1-877-909-5444. Or go check out their website, www.nattaxexperts.com. That's NATTAXEXPERTS.com. Tell them Jimmy sent you.
9 out of 10 geneticists agree.
Fade to Black is not your father's radio show on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the planet.
Hi, this is Chase Kletsky with Fate Magazine Radio, and you're listening to Jimmy Church and Fade to Black on the Game Changer Network and the KGRA digital broadcast station, where the Fader Knots rock.
Hi, this is Rob Reiner from Anvil, and you're listening to JimmyChurchRadio.com.
What's up? I'm Chris.
What up? This is Kyle Massey, and you're listening to Jimmy Church Radio.
Welcome back, Fade to Black. And you know, I've got to go. I'm going to do it right now. I'm going to go on the record. I'm going to say it's a tie between Jaws and All That Jazz. I have to. Because Jaws is great. But when you watch All That Jazz and you get to the end of that film, you know you've watched something real. So I'm going with a tie. And although Roy was great in Jaws, you know, in a lot of ways it was funny, but he did the part. He acted. He played it in All That Jazz. So I'm going tie. And I know it's not fair, but I have to. All right. Tonight, Tracy Twyman is here. We're going to be talking about an article that she's got posted right now at TracyTwyman.com. It's called Found Again, The Templar Artifacts of Hammer Pertzkal. So read that article. If you didn't read it today, check it out. You're going to want to go check it out after the show. And it is excerpts from her new book, Baphomet, The Mystery of Mysteries Unveiled. That book is coming out on Friday. You'll be able to start pre-ordering the book. I believe we'll talk to Tracy about that today. Okay? And there you go. All right? The book is officially, it's like printing now. It's hot off the press and will be available on Friday. On this day in history, 1975, the Edmund Fitzgerald sinks in Lake Superior, made famous by that 1976 Gordon Lightfoot song, The Wreck of the Edmund Fitzgerald. Fader fact, Calvin Klein's obsession for men is used by researchers to attract animals to cameras in the wilderness. That is a fader fact. Now, let's get to all the news that you know nothing about. We're about to have a worldwide catastrophe on our hands. Yes, it is here. Bigger than Syria. And I'm talking about Russia's track and field athletes could be banned from the 2016 Olympics in Rio after an independent report detailed an apparently state-sponsored doping program commissioned by the World Anti-Doping Agency, WADA, and carried out by the organization's former president, Dick Pound. The findings uncovered a deeply rooted culture of cheating at all levels. That's a quote from the report within Russian athletics. The report says that more than 1,400 samples were intentionally and maliciously destroyed by Moscow after a WADA plea to preserve them. The report states five allegations. Number one, the Russian secret police were inside the anti-doping laboratory. Number two, samples were destroyed before the key inspection. Number three, multiple bribes and extortions. Four, intimidation of doping testers. And number five, the use of false identities to dodge tests. Oh, yeah. It's going down. An international team of architects and scientists have observed thermal anomalies in the pyramids of Giza. Yes, Egyptian antiquities officials announced today. Thermal cameras detected higher temperatures in three adjacent stones at the bottom of the Great Pyramid. Officials said possible causes included the existence of empty areas inside the Great Pyramid, including internal air currents or the use of different building materials. It comes as experts search for hidden chambers within the pyramids. The tomb of Khufu, of course, the Great Pyramid, Khafre, and they were all three were built. The point that I'm trying to make here is they're saying, yeah, they were built between 2613 and 2494 BC. But a team of architects and scientists from Egypt, France, Canada, and Japan are using infrared thermography to survey the pyramids for the first time. And during sunrise, as the sun heats the limestone from the outside, they're detecting certain stones are hotter than the rest. You should see these photographs. A particularly impressive anomaly that I saw was found at ground level on the eastern side of the Great Pyramid. And when you see how the FLIR is photographing this, you'll see that there, out of all of those millions of stones, a few are hotter than the rest. The operation is called the Scan Pyramids Project. It began on October 25th, and it's expected to last through the end of 2016. This is big, big news. Now, the word of the month. What is the word of the month? It's kind of fallen in our laps. Now, check this out. In perhaps the most delicious heist in recent history, Eater reports that a mysterious band of French robbers made off with more than 8,818 pounds of cheese last week. The dairy theft occurred in Doubs in eastern France, and according to the Telegraph, French police were called after the bandits weaseled their way through a store barbed wire fence and used a crowbar to break into the establishment. They swiped about 100 wheels of Comté, which officials believe they'll likely try to sell on the black market. The hard-aged cheese is a luxury product, and it's made using unpasteurized cow's milk in France's Francais Comté region, and it sells for, are you ready for this? $43 a pound. That is really good cheese. Google is ignoring everything the Terminator franchise taught us and is releasing TensorFlow, an open source software that helps computers learn quicker than ever before. The software is a branch of artificial intelligence called machine learning. The tech that has already found a home in Google Search, Google Photos, and Gmail. Tech giants like Google, Facebook, and Amazon, they're all working with machine learning to better the services of what they offer, like smart searches, ad targeting, and product recommendations. Machine learning is now shifting into a complex realm where researchers are creating computer models that can see and even understand what it's looking at. Around a week ago, a strange object was flying around Spain in the countryside. The article is posted over on our Facebook page at Jimmy Church Radio. You can go check it out right now. The object turned out to be what they think is space junk, and it probably is part of a rocket or maybe a satellite that re-entered the Earth's atmosphere, landing in a field. As reported by El Pay in English, by the way, on Sunday, this past Sunday, a second and very similar piece of space junk was discovered in the Murcia countryside a few kilometers from the first discovery. This second object is also spherical in shape and is almost identical to the first object found by some shepherds. Reportedly, the object is approximately a meter in diameter and is covered in a heat-resistant material. All of the pictures are posted. You can go check it out over on our Facebook page. Spain's Civil Guard was called into the scene, where they immediately activated their NRBQ protocol, which is used to investigate nuclear, radiological, bacterial, or chemical threats. Officials are concerned that several objects could have fallen. That's right. Apparently reported November 3rd, 7 to 8 balls of fire had been seen falling in the early hours of the morning. Insert joke here. The rain in Spain is actually UFOs. A U.S. federal judge yesterday, for the first time, ordered the National Security Agency to cease collecting the phone call records of a lawyer and his firm, providing an unprecedented but narrow and largely symbolic victory to privacy advocates. U.S. District Court Judge Richard Leon granted an injunction to bar the NSA from collecting the phone metadata of California attorney J.J. Little and his legal practice. Unlike previous rulings against the NSA's program to vacuum up and suck up America's call data, which was exposed publicly by Edward Snowden back in 2013, Leon's opinion does not grant a stay, meaning it will take effect immediately. The NSA is scheduled to end its controversial bulk collection program in favor of a more targeted system in a couple of weeks. That new regime, as mandated by Congress earlier this year, will become active November 29th. I'll have more news that you know nothing about later on in the program. This is Fade to Black. Tonight, Tracy Twyman right here. Excited. Her new book is Baphomet, The Mystery of Mysteries Unveiled. We're going to discuss all of that and her new article, Found Again, the Templar Artifacts of Hammer Purgsgall. That's right. This is Fade to Black on the Game Changer Network and KGRA The Planet. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Follow us on Twitter at JChurch Radio. Email is Jimmy at JimmyChurchRadio.com. I'll be right back.
This is Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
The station that talks the net, KGRA Radio.
Hello, I'm Katie, and you're listening to my main man, Jimmy Church, on JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Hi, this is Ray Sobbs here, repping the planet, and you're listening to my good friend, Jimmy Church, Fade to Black, on the Game Changer Network and the KGRA Digital Broadcast Station.
Imagine no longer being tied down to your computer, but having the freedom to take live talk radio with you anywhere you go. TalkStream Live introduces our first ever iPhone application. The talk shows you follow now follow you, and your iPhone is now the fastest and easiest way to stay connected to the best talk radio on the internet. Let TalkStream Live transform the way you listen to radio. Listen to live talk shows 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Mobile talk radio from TalkStream Live. Now available in the iTunes App Store.
This is Toby Kebbell. You're listening to JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Don't hurt me, Jimmy. I'm only little.
Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And this is Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers.
Well, the...
Yes.
We are of the Honey Brothers.
Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And I'm Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers.
And you're listening to Jimmy Church.
The Revolution.
All right, you fader knots. Studio Dome has done it once again. A new Studio Dome Fader Knot special. Introducing the Studio Dome Boom Box Bluetooth speaker. It's got a rear-firing bass film subwoofer and dual 52mm main speakers. You'll never listen to your tablet or cell phone speakers again. Just click on the Studio Dome banner, use the promo code Jimmy, and you'll get the SBB for $49 and free shipping. And get a Buddy 4-port USB charger for free. That's a $19.99 value right there. And they'll throw in a Buddy in the box. It's the best deal on the net anywhere. Just go to jimmychurchradio.com, click on the Studio Dome banner, enter the promo code Jimmy, go Beckley Teppy.
This is Micah Hanks of the Graylian Report, and you're listening to Jimmy Church on Fade to Black. Across the globe on the Game Changer Radio Network and the one and only KGRA Radio, the planet.
Welcome back to Fade to Black. So, a couple of weeks ago, before that, but Tracy Twyman sent me a press release. And I read the press release, and I was like, you know, go Tracy, go. And then I go back to the press release, and I click on it again, and I actually do the due diligence of going back and reading the article that she had posted about the Knights Templar. And, you know, Knights Templar, I'm there no matter what. I'm always there. So I go and I read it. And after I was done, this was after one of the shows a couple of weeks ago. And I woke up and I immediately called Tracy the next day. And I said, holy crap, that was the most amazing thing I have ever read. It was real. And we talked for quite a bit. And I said, Tracy, we've got to talk. Let's get you back on the show. Let's do Coast to Coast. Let's do this. Your new book is coming out. And she said, Jimmy, let's do this, man. Let's go. Let's go. Let's do this. When can we do it? And tonight is the night. And then this Friday, Tracy will be back on with me over at Coast to Coast. It's an amazing article. It's an amazing read. It is called Found Again, the Templar Artifacts. You need to go to Tracy's website and read that. It's excerpts from her new book, which is Baphomet, the Mystery of Mysteries Unveiled. That book is coming out this week. You can pre-order it now. And I believe Tracy has made some special arrangements for that. We'll talk to her about that in just a second. She is an American nonfiction writer. She was born right here in Kansas City, Missouri, United States of America. She has been writing on the esoteric side of history and current events for over 20 years. She has dealt with topics like secret societies, ancient myths, vampires, demonology, ceremonial magics, divination, alchemy, mind control, mystical royal bloodlines, all of the things that I love to talk about every night on this show. The last time she was with us, we talked about her last book, Clock Shavings. It was one of the greatest conversations I've ever had on Fade to Black. And I would like to welcome back Tracy Twyman. Good evening, Tracy. How are you?
I'm doing great. Thanks. Hey, did you get the copy of Clock Shavings that I finally sent you a few months after the show?
Are you kidding me? I pounded those pages.
Okay, good. I'm glad you received it.
Yeah, thank you so much for that. So, Tracy, let's go ahead. I know I just threw you under the bus, but I called you up in a panic, didn't I? Tracy, that was just, you know, and I think you were a little bit, humbled, and that's what impressed me. I was just all over you just saying, Tracy, this is the greatest. I mean, this is real. This is real research. This is real stuff. This is not fluff. And, you know, how did you do it? And you and I stayed on the phone for a couple of hours that day. But
I remember, yeah.
Yeah, that conversation really happened, didn't it? did I surprise you that day? Just
well,
out of
you seemed very excited.
I was.
So that excited me, you know, because I'm glad that, you know, I did something noteworthy and that you felt the same way. Yeah. I sent out this press release. I felt like this was a big deal, you know. And I sent it out to all the newspapers, especially the newspapers in the UK where I found these things in the British Museum. I thought, surely, you know, especially – I think I sent it on the weekend before October 13th, which is this significant anniversary date of the arrest of the Templars. And I just thought, oh, I know that the newspapers are going to pick it up and you know, I'm going to be a big famous star because of this. And it just dropped like a lead balloon. I mean, nobody – nobody responded to this press release at all until you finally came along about 2 or 3 weeks later.
You know,
you understood the importance of it. So thank you.
Well, and there's something. Okay, now listen, I'm going to tell my audience right now, some of the stuff that we're going to discuss tonight is certainly of adult content. And the article, it Tracy does not hold back in what the content on the carvings of these two caskets actually mean. Also, the accusations against the Knights Templar about what they were really up to. Now, what this actually means, that's what Tracy's investigation and research entails. But it is sensitive. If you have children around tonight and you may not want them to hear some of the stuff that we're going to talk about tonight, I need to get that disclaimer out there right now because it is, well, salacious might be the right word, but it's also, all of the stuff that you hear about when we talk about Baphomet or Satanism or demons or the occult and things that they do privately, going through Aleister Crowley, all of that is revealed here. So we're going to discuss that. And I talked to Tracy about this, saying that, well, we have the opportunity on Coast, but we have to also stay in the context of certain regulations to do that kind of show. And on Fade to Black, we can go ahead and open it up and actually talk about the content. And we're going to do that tonight. The pictures are graphic. The details are graphic. And what they are and the implications are very adult in nature. And that's the conversation tonight. So with that, was that a good enough disclaimer, Tracy? Did I lay it out?
Yeah. You made it sound very ominous. But at least these are old objects. They're maybe a couple hundred years old, maybe 700 years old. We don't know. It depends on whether they're actually Templar artifacts or not. But when you look at old things and they have pictures of naked people doing stuff, it just looks interesting. It's not as – yes, it's graphic, but it's like, oh, it's history. So, you know, it doesn't shock you as much. So
right.
I guess what I'm saying is if I don't know. It's not like looking at a Playboy or something. You're just looking at pictures from a long time ago of what, you know, what – people used to be into.
Well,
so
you know,
it just makes it a little bit, separates it a little bit, you know, makes it easier to take.
Yeah, you said ominous, but you know what? Honestly, it's I think I was throwing a softball out there. It's pretty gnarly. And the thing
that's true, actually.
Yeah, it is. It's right there. But also you hear about or you see, you know what's funny, Tracy, when you'll watch a movie like The Omen, or you'll see these different Hollywood productions and you'll see somebody flipping through some old book in a library, right? And they'll show a woodcut of some crazy thing going on with, you know, Baphomet and a couple of goats, you know, some crazy thing, you know, they'll show it. And you always wondered, you know, where do they get this stuff from? I never see anything like this. But this and these photographs directly, you know, provided to you from the museum that they took for you show exactly these graphic images that we hear about, but you never actually see them. You know, they're always hidden away and it's always a rumor. You know what I mean? But you found it.
Well, that's the thing about the accusations of the Templars. You know, when I started researching this book, you know, I like so many people had heard, yeah, rumors and sort of generalized stories about what happened to them, what they were accused of, that they confessed to it under torture, things having to do with blasphemy and weird sex orgies and you know, worshiping idols, demons, things like that. But, you know, it really, I really had to take the time that I have taken, me and my partner, Alexander Rivera, into, you know, researching what the documentation of that is, what specifically they were accused of, what specifically they confessed to. And until I really started looking into this particular subject we're talking about tonight, having to do with these artifacts and the person that wrote about them, Joseph von Hammer-Purgstall, who wrote about them in the early 1800s. Yeah, I was unaware that there were physical objects that supposedly depicted what the Templars were doing, that supposedly belonged to them. So that's what I discovered in the research here, is that Baphomet, of course, just to throw this out there, Baphomet is the name of the idol that the Templars were accused of worshiping. So when they were arrested, and of course, Templars were crusading knights in the Middle Ages during the Crusades. They were arrested by the King of France in 1307. He was sort of colluding with the Vatican at the time, or the church. I'm not even sure if it was called the Vatican back then, but he was colluding with the Catholic Church. He was sort of in control of the church at the time, because the French monarchy for a while had actually sort of had more control over the church than the other way around. So he sort of finagled and got the Pope involved in, you know, arresting and prosecuting the Templars for all of these charges. And they were accused of worshiping this demon called Baphomet. And so when I decided to research this book, what I really wanted to find out is what was known, what was claimed at the time about this Baphomet. You know, what was it? Because they described it as being a severed head. And then later in the imagery of Baphomet, this demon, kind of got elaborated by other writers. So I was trying to figure out how this idea had developed over time, right? And so that's how I happened upon this book. Called it was written in Latin. It's called Mysterium Baphometis Revelatum, and it's written by Joseph von Hammer-Purgstall. No one had translated it. So this is a book that has been written about by people who write about the Templars ever since then, and has really been very influential in the development of this idea of Baphomet. So in the mid-1800s, an occultist named Eliphas Levi developed the idea of Baphomet much further, wrote about what he thought Baphomet was as a demon, what his, you know, what the meaning of it was. And he actually drew a hieroglyph of it, a picture of this guy that everyone is now familiar with, because, you know, we've all seen it in horror movies. And if you've ever had a tarot deck, usually the devil is basically, it's based on this image that Eliphas Levi drew of Baphomet. So that's the picture that has the guy with a goat head and breasts sitting on a throne. That's the way Baphomet is depicted more commonly now. And it turns out that Eliphas Levi's depiction of Baphomet and the development of the idea into what it is now is very much influenced by this book in Latin that we found and we had translated. And it has a bunch of these pictures in it that are from what the author said. He found these artifacts at churches that are on properties that used to belong to the Templars.
Right.
So his theory was that some of them are like frescoes and things on the walls of the churches. And so his theory was most of the churches walls were still the same, you know, that there were still some things that are left over from the Templars in these churches.
Right.
And then some of them were like idols and caskets. And so his book was full of all these images from these artifacts, line drawings of them. So no one had really put these things on online or anything. There's a few samples of the pictures that you can find here and there. Excuse me. But Google Books had scanned this book in Latin, but they hadn't folded out the pages that had the pictures on them. So they messed up all the pictures. So when you try to find this thing online, you're going to find it in Latin with messed up pictures, and you know, you can't do much with it. So, you know, we had to track down the book, get good scans of the pictures, I had to hire someone to translate the Latin, which was not easy because the Latin itself is incorrect in a lot of places. It's kind of sloppy Latin. And then there's just a lot of very peculiar words in there. So I had to find someone that was not only proficient in Latin, but also Greek. There's lots of Greek in there too. And also someone who could.
Oh, I think we lost you, Tracy. I don't know if you can hear me. Wow, that's bizarre. I still show you live.
You can't hear me.
Oh, there you are. Okay. You said right as you were cut off, some sections were Greek.
Well, I was just saying that, yes, it was a very delicate process, really, to try to get this thing translated. And we had to find the right person, which he did. He did it over a period of several months. And actually, it affected him a lot. He said that it was giving him occult hallucinations. He said he was having poltergeist activity based on having to read this material and look at the pictures. It was creeping him out, basically, a lot. And he said it wasn't anything he had ever experienced before. So that's why the translator decided not to use his name. So he's anonymous, but he did a really good job. But yeah, apparently, not only the translator, but even the guy that worked with him, because what happened over time as he was working on it, his Parkinson's disease got dramatically worse all of a sudden. Well, and, you know, that could just be because of his, you know, nature. But we all got kind of scared about it when he suddenly got really sick and he was saying that he was being disturbed by working on this book. But he managed to get it finished, but he had to get someone else to do the typing for him. And that other person, the assistant, also started being haunted of working on the book.
I'm going to jump in and say that when I was reading your excerpts, I was genuinely affected by it too. I mean, it's heavy. The material is very, very heavy. And I wouldn't doubt it if there was poltergeist activity in my house too that night, because I finished the article and I just sat back and thought, wow, really? I mean, it was just heavy. And I stressed with everybody. I put it out there online today and said, if you read anything, you know, today or this month or this year, it's got to be this article. And it's something that, well, it's because it goes somewhere, Tracy. The investigation and the research actually go somewhere. I'm looking over on Twitter, and what I wasn't going to post today, but everybody has found it upon themselves to go ahead and do this. I didn't want to do the line drawings. I just wanted to do the pictures of the caskets, which I asked you, you know, if we could go ahead and do that. And you said, sure. But now I'm looking at the line drawings that were from Hammer's book, and there's a couple of them. I mean, they're pretty graphic, and they are exactly what you think you're looking at. That's what is carved on these caskets. So as I've gone ahead and retweeted these, and if you want to see the line drawings that I'm talking about, just go to @JChurchRadio, #F2B. And you will see the line drawings that I am referring to that are in large part from the caskets. Now, let's back up and set the stage here, Tracy. You were able to chase down the museum where the caskets are now. How did that happen?
Well, first of all, I only found two caskets. And there's tons of pictures in the book, so I only found two things. And actually, I need to make a correction here on the air that I haven't been able to make yet on my website. I'm going to do it tonight. But I realized today that actually none of these pictures on the caskets are in Hammer Purgstall's book specifically, although he describes them. But the pictures from one of the caskets are in this other book that came a little bit later that was largely based on Hammer Purgstall's work. So that one was called Worship of the Generative Powers by Thomas Wright. I think 1835 or something is when that came out. It's all about priapism. You know, Priapus, the god with the large penis in Greek mythology.
Right.
The author of this book thinks that that is really what ties together so many of these sort of fertility cults and things like that throughout history. So in his book, he's tying together the things that the Templars were accused of doing with witchcraft, the witch's Sabbat and things like that, saying it's all part of the same tradition. And that Baphomet really is sort of a Priapean god. And, you know, he's kind of right. And the research that we did kind of corroborates what he's saying. I mean, we have a slightly larger or more expanded theory, but he's on the right track in a way. So anyway, it was in this book, Worship of the Generative Powers, that I saw a reference to the person that he said Hammer Purgstall got some of his artifacts from, including the casket that, like I said, Hammer Purgstall describes. But for some reason, none of those pictures are actually in his book. Anyway, Thomas Wright said they were in the Duke de Blacas collection. This guy's name is, I think it was Louis, because there's two Duke de Blacases. I think it was Louis that had these things, gave them to Hammer Purgstall, told him that, you know, I think these are connected to the Templars. And then eventually that guy sold his collection to the British Museum. So I saw this in this book from 1835, and I just thought, hey, I wonder if they're still there, you know? And so I wrote to the British Museum. I asked them if the Duke de Blacas collection was still there. Sure enough, it is. But it's not on display, or at least these things aren't on display. They're in, like, the back catalog.
You're, of course, of course.
It's in some kind of back room or something. So, but I found them on their website, where they, I guess, have all this, you know, pictures of all this stuff cataloged. They, what they did was they sent me a link to the Duke de Blacas collection online. And I just started looking through it and looking through it. And eventually, and there were like over 1,000 things in there. But eventually I found one of the caskets that corresponds to the pictures in Thomas Wright's book.
Right.
And the description in Hammer Purgstall's book. And then I was lucky because I actually stumbled upon another one too, that I think there's some description of in Thomas Wright's book, but there's no pictures from it anywhere, and I didn't even know it existed. Nobody knew, you know, and I just stumbled on it, and I realized, oh, this is obviously from the same artist. It's the same
style.
You know, part of the same collection. So,
yes, yes.
These things definitely, the two caskets definitely go together, and they're definitely part of the kind of stuff that Hammer Purgstall ran into and what he based his book on. And yeah, it's what it seems to me, Jimmy, is that either these artifacts are Templar artifacts, and I'm not at all convinced of that, or they were made specifically to be used in this fashion. They were made to be used to accuse the Templars of doing these things. And if that happened, which other people have theorized, in fact, that's sort of the going wisdom on this subject, is that even the museum itself, the second casket, is labeled fake. So whatever it purports to be, they think it's fake. And I'm trying to get a conversation going with someone there so they can tell me exactly what they know about it. I haven't gotten that information yet. But the theory is that this Duke de Blacas guy, you know, he was a legitimist during the French Revolution. So he was against the revolution. And the revolution was, of course, as you know, largely fomented by the Illuminati, you know, a secret society that had infiltrated a lot of the Masonic lodges and used its power to have this revolution against the ruling royal bloodlines and the nobility and things like that. So this guy, you know, was basically fighting for his title and his lands, and he was against the revolution. And some people think that he conspired with others to concoct these fake artifacts, and they even think Hammer Purgstall was part of the conspiracy. And the whole point is just to make Freemasons look bad via making the Templars look bad. So, you know, that would make the revolution look bad. And I think that's kind of twisted logic. And also, I mean, it's possible.
Well, it is. If you look at how society works today, you know, if you want to bring somebody down, if, you know, you've got something against somebody, accuse them of child pornography, right? And, yeah. And the accusation, it could be groundless, but once it's thrown out there, you're tarnished for life. You know, you just can't get away from it. Or anything like that. You know, you just let's go there. And that appears, if that's what their intention was back then, you know, a smear campaign against the Templars, go ahead and go in this direction. Go with cooking babies, right? Let's go. Let's bring that up. And let's produce these artifacts with these caskets and these orgies with animals and goats and children and boiling cauldrons with let's do all of that. And if that was their intention, certainly it sort of worked. But they didn't have the internet back then. They only had the ability to publish books and get the word out, you know, and that was their angle. It could be. It's possible.
Yeah, but it's a good point. They didn't have the internet not even really, I guess there were newspapers, but I mean, how broadly could this information have been spread at the time? Not very.
Right.
What could they have done with this? And you were saying, okay, these are the sort of accusations that one would make to try to smear someone. And certainly, you know, just like I was saying before, the accusations against the Templars are very similar to what witches were accused of and also confessed to the Inquisition. And the Gnostics, you know, in the early days of Christianity and before, were accused of this, the same exact things. And then in Europe, you know, sometimes these accusations would be made against Jews too. I mean, it's basically the same set of accusations that's made against every sort of enemy of society in each generation. But at the same time, as we show in our book, there's also actually a continuity of tradition between all of these groups that have been accused of this. So it's by no means cut and dry whether or not any of these people were guilty or not, because there are reasons why these groups were accused of this in the first place, you know?
And he certainly, Hammer Purgsdahl, went there in the darkest of context. I mean, he didn't hold back.
No. Okay. Here's something I want to say too, is that this isn't the only book he wrote. And in fact, what he was an Orientalist.
Right.
He was known as a scholar on the Middle East. And, that's what they called it, the Orient back then, if you were in Europe. He's still considered the expert on quite a number of things. He wrote a book about the assassins that's still quoted all the time today.
That's right.
He was a very respected Orientalist, is what I'm saying. And so I find it a bit odd that people are so, you know, so willing to assume that he would put his reputation on the line for a political motive. I don't think that's really what was going on. But yeah, I mean, he also, it seems like in the beginning of his career, he had a very academic look on the Templars and even had different theories about what Baphomet meant. But by the time he wrote this book, he was just, you could tell, disgusted. The anger comes through in every line, that he's just been looking at picture after picture of people having sex with animals and children and committing blasphemous, heretical rituals. And he's just totally disgusted by the time he wrote the book. It really comes through in the language. So, and you can see why. I mean, if you believe that all these things are connected to the Templars, you can understand why.
Tracy Twyman, Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. More with Tracy and the Knights Templar and her article, Templar Artifacts. It's amazing. Stay with us. I'll be right back.
Way out here, we listen to Jimmy Church.
You're listening to Fade to Black.
Always on the edge of the hottest alternative talk. Jimmy Church with Fade to Black. KGRARadio.com.
¿Qué tal, mis amigos? Yo soy Mario Carson el Tiburón. Y los invito para que escuchen a mi buen amigo Jimmy Church Radio. ¡Claro que sí!
Did you ever turn to your radio for your favorite talk show to find that it's been preempted for this?
In the air to deep right center. Back goes Lewis to the wall. And it's all here!
Or this?
And I'm ashamed of you, Hillary, for voting for it.
Do you have a favorite talk radio program that's not available in your city? Just go to TalkStreamLive.com for links to the best streaming talk radio shows. At TalkStream Live, you will find live talk shows 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. All your favorites are here. With such a large selection, you will also discover some new favorites. On the go and still want to listen? With a mobile smartphone, simply type TalkStream Live on your internet browser. Now you can take internet radio with you. You will also find hundreds of music, news, and sports streams. Best of all, the TalkStream Live directory is free and there's never a login required. Remember TalkStreamLive.com, the fastest route between you and your favorite talk radio show.
You are listening to Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Network.
Oi, oi, I'm Rhys Evans. You're listening to Jimmy Church. This is Revolution. The Revolution will not be televised. The Revolution is on radio. Ciao.
Welcome back to Fade to Black. Tonight, Tracy Twyman is with us discussing her latest article. It's called Found Again, the Templar Artifacts of Hammer Purgstall. The article you can read in its totality over at her website, TracyTwyman.com. And it is excerpts from her new book, Baphomet, The Mystery of Mysteries Unveiled. Tracy, when the book comes out Friday?
It should be available for purchase by Friday. I'm not sure that it will actually be back from the printers at that moment, so we might call it pre-order. But it's basically going to be shipped out, you know, within the next couple of weeks here. Everyone's going to get it well before Christmas. And, I mean, everyone who orders it, you know, around this time. And so, yes, it's coming out this week, let's say.
Okay, let's I want to discuss – I'm going to post up the – the first image that Rita, if you could go ahead and post, it's called Meta the lid, and it's Meta Lid 3. Post that JPEG. It is the lid, and it's the one that I think Thomas Wright called it the most interesting of the artifacts from Hammer Purgstall, and it is an actual depiction of Baphomet, and so. Go ahead.
Yeah, go ahead.
No, go ahead.
Well, that's what Hammer Purgstall kind of decided. What he saw in these artifacts, which I believe several of them came from different places. So that's interesting in itself, that you get the same image, which really you don't see anywhere else. It has no other provenance in known mythology. But you see this image repeatedly in his pictures. So is it just a coincidence, or did they concoct it this way? But he found the same figure over and over again in different churches in these different countries in Europe. What it is a lady on this casket. It looks like a lady, and in a bunch of the other versions, she has a beard, so she kind of looks like a dude.
Right.
with breasts.
Right.
But on this one, it looks more feminine. You don't see a beard. But any rate, she's got a cape. She's got a crown that has towers on it, which is usually indicative of the goddess Cybele. And she's naked, by the way, except for the cape, and holding chains that are connected to the sky. In each version, usually she's holding these chains. On this particular casket, the chains are connected to a sun and a moon that are inverted. So, and also the chains kind of look like she has pulled them off of her ankles.
Yes.
Like, so two things it looks like are happening. She's pulling the chains off of her ankles, and it looks like also she's pulling the sun and the moon down from the sky with the chains. And I'll explain what I think that means in a minute. But as far as this meat character, he called her meat. He says this is what Baphomet is based on, is this character meat. And meat comes from metis, which is a Greek word for wisdom. And his interpretation of the word Baphomet was baptism of wisdom. And that's what he thought. He thought that was kind of a ritual that they were probably doing.
Right, right.
And in fact, a lot of my research was about the etymology of Baphomet. And there's lots of different theories on it, but they all seem to go back to this idea of wisdom and immersing in wisdom. So I think that's probably the best interpretation of the name, actually, baptism of wisdom. And the baptism of wisdom concept is something that has an origin also. It seems to at least go back to the Corpus Hermeticum and Hermes Trismegistus from Egypt telling his student about the idea that that there's a bowl of wisdom that God sent down from heaven for us all to compete with each other for access to. And then whoever has the strongest mind and constitution and is able to immerse himself in the wisdom and come back out a whole person is, the winner, I guess. the enlightened people are the ones that can do that. So
it's
a description of what the baptism of wisdom is. And so anyway, that's what this casket, he says, depicts this woman, the goddess of wisdom. Hello?
I'm here.
Oh, something just interjected in my ear.
Oh.
That was strange. Okay. At any rate, this woman is depicted over and over again in these artifacts. Tamara Bergstahl thinks it's this this personification of the wisdom goddess, which the Gnostics called her Sophia. In fact, that's a word that's used in the Christian tradition. It's like the wisdom of God, and it's kind of personified as a female figure, and a lot of people kind of equate it with the Holy Spirit. So Hammer Bergstahl thought that the Templars had several influences, but one of them was Gnosticism. Specifically, he thought Ophite Gnosticism, which was a sect that purportedly engaged in orgies with snakes. And Sophia in the Gnostic tradition is, one of the main figures, the goddess figure. And in Gnosticism generally, the idea is that the God of the Bible is an evil God. He's not the largest God. There's another God above him. But he created this physical world with evil intent, basically, and trapped us inside of this prison of matter, and is controlling us fiendishly and trying to gain from us somehow, and the true initiated, the true enlightened person should somehow try to gain wisdom from beyond this prison and somehow find a way to escape from it. Their idea is that this Sophia goddess will somehow bring you that wisdom that you need to get out of the world that was created by the God of the Bible. You will immerse yourself in her wisdom, and then you will be free somehow. And then what we found from researching these Gnostic traditions and even looking at the rumors about the Templars, and then there was there are Gnostic-influenced groups in medieval Europe that the Templars were associated with, like the Cathars, that their traditions also helped us try to tease out what this baptism of wisdom concept might have been. If it's real, if what Hammer Bergstahl is saying is true, that the Templars engaged in this ritual called the baptism of wisdom, what might it have been? And We have several different interpretations of this. Like, there's a clean version. You know, there's a baptism of wisdom like we described that's sort of a, initiation and an enlightenment. It could come in any number of ways through meditation or anything like that. But then there's the dark version. And we piece this together from, looking at witchcraft traditions, certain Gnostic sects and their traditions, things that they were accused of doing by their enemies. What it seems to me, this image of meat holding the chains and pulling the sun and the moon down from the sky, is that it represents the destruction of creation in order to escape the prison. And the reason why I say this is there's an inscription around this particular casket, and the way that it was interpreted on in Thomas Wright's book, my son just burst into the room. The way that Hammer Purgstall interpreted the inscription was, he said it was written in like Arabic words, but they were kind of transposed. It was kind of a code that you had to decode. He said it meant the distinguished charity of meat uproots the enemy. This is really complicated, but I'll just try to distill it for you. The distinguished charity of meat, he said that represents pederasty. So in other words, having sex with children.
Right.
All right, and uproots the enemy. Who's the enemy? That's the God of the Bible, the God that created everything. Now, in Gnosticism, they also talk about the archons, which they identify with the heavenly bodies. So the sun, the moon, and all the planets are the archons. And these are kind of like the underlings underneath the God of the creator God. The archons are his helpers that kind of keep everything in order in this prison that we're in. So, ancient man used to think that, the stars and the planets controlled our fate. And the Gnostics took that quite literally, and that's why they decided that the archons were the enemy, the planets are the enemy. The way to get free is to break their influence over you. And so it took a long way to get there, but what I think this image is depicting is meat pulling the sun and the moon down from the sky, the heavens falling, and basically destroying God's creation. And I think the baptism of wisdom, which is a blasphemous ritual involving sex with children in this context, is what they thought would make that happen.
I want everybody to go to, if you don't see him, if you're not using Twitter tonight, if you go to jimmychurchradio.com, you see Tracy's picture on the homepage. Right to the right of her picture, there's a little button, gallery. Click on that. All of the images that we are talking about are in the gallery, as well as the cover to her new book. The cover to the casket that we're talking about right now is on the bottom row in the middle. That is the casket lid that we're referring to. Now, also, Tracy, all of these images that are in the gallery, you requested the British Museum to photograph the caskets for you, right?
Yeah, they had photos of the second casket, the one that was just a fluke and an accident that I ran into.
Right.
But the one that matches up with the one in Thomas Wright's book, they only had one blurry photo of the cover of it, and I think one of the sides. So I had to pay them to photograph the other sides and to get usable photographs.
Because they're amazing. They're high-res, amazing photographs. They really took the time to do these right.
Well, I hope so. I paid them enough. and that's not enough. They, in order to actually use the photographs for anything, I have to pay them over $2,000 more. So
yeah, of course.
That's one of the things I'm hoping to recoup once we get this book published out there. And we have a Kickstarter going right now. Actually, we started it yesterday to basically for the purpose of just trying to reimburse us for all. I had to pay the translator and everything, so I've invested quite a lot into this project, and It would be cool if people could help me get my money back as fast as possible.
Yeah,
but the book's going to come out either way. You know, you don't have to worry that I'm waiting for funding for the book. I'm not. But it'd be really helpful if you guys could, support the Kickstarter and help me get my money back as soon as possible.
Yeah, the links are over at Tracy Twyman's, TracyTwyman.com. Back to the cover, the lid.
Yes.
Down at the bottom, we have the ominous pentagram, and it's not inverted, it's upright. There's a skull in the middle, and then there's a seven-pointed star in the lower left-hand corner. What's going on down there?
Well, I could come up with some theories, but I mean, the seven-pointed star is probably related to the seven archons. The pentagram is, just a symbol of magic, and the Levi Baphomet even has a pentagram on his head.
Right.
And then the skull, of course, I think, that's another representation of Baphomet, because that's sort of the touch point that the Templars actually used during their rituals. What I think is that when the Templars were, actually doing their rituals, they were using these heads. The evidence shows that there was probably one, real head, and the theories are that maybe it was John the Baptist's head, who knows, but there was like one, one idol, then a bunch of copies of that. So probably in every Templar preceptory, they had a head of some sort that they would use as their Baphomet, and it's just a way of contacting him. This is what you do in ritual magic. You have some kind of an idol that your spirit that you're trying to contact can use to get to you, and you need some kind of focal point. So I think that the skull was their focal point, but the Baphomet spirit is something much more nebulous, and that's why it's actually a very broad and complicated concept, which we go into in the book in great detail. And I think that's why they, Eliphas Levi and some of these other occultists later were able to depict Baphomet as a goat-headed deity, because he wasn't the skull. The skull was just a touch point, basically. So, yeah, I think the skull on this casket is probably a representation of the Baphomet head.
And did Hammerbergstall ever reference who he thought might have been inside of one of these caskets, if that's what they were used for?
Oh, no. I think that they're like – I would have preferred to call them coffers, because I don't think that they're big enough to put a body in. I think they're like little boxes. But they might need – see, I haven't physically seen them yet. I don't think anyone has in a long time, except the photographers maybe. But I think that they might be ossuaries or something, how you
put
bones in a smaller box. So maybe they were that. I think Pergstall also talked about – he said that they had coffers with representations of Baphomet in them to put their money in, because the Templars believed that Baphomet made them rich. So maybe these were treasury coffers. I don't know. These are things that we need to find out. Now, there's so much information in the new book. It's 650 pages. But we've got another one coming out in January that's going to be the translation of the Hammerbergstall book, and it'll have all my commentary in it and footnotes and stuff. And so I'm going to put it out very soon here, but there's still a month or so of time I have to find some more information. And I'm hoping that people like you, Jimmy, and other people in the media can help me really blow this open so that I can get some help here. And I assume that other researchers are going to pick up the pieces here do the rest of the work that's necessary. I mean, if there's anyone in England right now, you can probably get a lot more done than I can over here. So, there's a lot more information that's needed here. Basically, what I've done is given the world what it needs to solve the rest of this mystery here, because it looks like, it was all just sitting there all along. The Latin needed to be translated. Now the artifacts need to be found, and I found two of them, but there's I don't know how many dozens more, and I tried to find some of these churches, but most of the churches aren't there anymore that he mentions, and even the towns that he said they were in have been renamed to other towns, so it's it can be done, but it's going to be quite a lot of work to try to track down everything that was happening back then, what, you know, what he was working with. But that's what needs to be done.
Now, let's go to the second image, which is the end of the casket. Read a post bull sacrifice and cauldron, and number three, bull sacrifice and cauldron. Well, that's kind of self-explanatory, isn't it? But I like your description of what's going on. And Tracy, after, you know, I'm reading your description, then I go back, because when I first looked at it, it looks, well, it is what it is. But then I read your description of it, then I go back, and that's exactly what's going on. So I'll let you do the description. What is going on the end? This is on the end of the casket.
Are you talking about the bull or
yes.
The
one with the smoking cauldron, and it looks like he's like holding the bull's head.
Oh, okay.
And then there's
are we looking at the right one here? Okay, there's one where there's a bull, and they're putting a garland on him. And he's up on an altar, so you can't really tell, are they worshiping the calf or are they about to kill it in a sacrifice? And in fact, the sources here, you know, Hammer Purgstall and Thomas Wright, they both describe it differently. And there are references to this casket, even though they don't have pictures of it in any of the books. So, it's an unclear whether they think that the bull is being worshipped or about to be sacrificed, and those things aren't mutually exclusive either, because you could have a bull worshipping sect that also sacrifices bulls. But and then on the other side, I think this might be what you're talking about. On the end of the casket, then you have a human who is on an altar being burned.
Yes.
As a burnt sacrifice. So I think that there's definitely one sacrifice of a human and possibly a bull sacrifice happening also. And it's interesting because actually in one of Hammer Purgstall's earlier books before he wrote this one, he referenced Baphomet just maybe about a paragraph in this other book that was all about ancient Arabic hieroglyphs. I'm trying to remember what it was, but basically he said that he thought Baphomet at the time, that was a few years earlier, he thought it had to do with calf worship, and he had some other etymology that he went through different than the baptism of wisdom one. So it's interesting that a few years later, after writing that, he finds these caskets, and then he thinks that, you know, well, and you can see for yourself, there's bull worship going on. But yeah, the word Baphomet, interestingly, there was a reference to it before the Templars. And this is the earliest one I can find. But there's a this book called Ancient Hieroglyphs Explained actually talks about a entity called Baphomet. And instead of depicting him like any of these other ways that I've described so far, they show him as a beetle, like a beetle with a human head. But then the description of him is what it means. They say he's the sun of suns and the moon of moons and the secret of all secrets. And that's something that I actually found in a lot of other literature too. Like Eliphas Levi kind of refers to Baphomet as the same thing, is just the biggest secret, you know, the most important thing in the world.
Right.
And then Albert Mackey also in a book that he edited that was about Freemasonry. That it also makes reference to Baphomet as being this sort of all-encompassing transcendental figure. And in fact, that's that kind of seems to be what the idea is. Again, from the research that we did, it seems like the idea of Baphomet, in addition to being the devil and all of the things that I've already mentioned, he's kind of like in alchemy what they call the universal agent. Or the philosophic mercury. And what that is that's the agent that allows the magical transformation to happen. If you were doing a ceremonial magic ritual and you try to turn someone into a toad.
Right.
The
right.
magic is being done by the universal agent.
Right.
And in alchemy, if you're turning lead into gold, it's the universal agent that makes the change happen. And so Levi and Albert Pike and Albert Mackey and several of these other occultists and Freemason writers have basically said that that's what Baphomet was.
Do you think they ever knew? And if all of that is the case, and I agree with all of that, then they're never going to let that the true nature of Baphomet or the knowledge or anything. They're not going to let that secret go. That would be that would be the secret of secrets. You know what I mean? And that's why he is so hard to research. One of the hardest things to do is go on the net and search for Baphomet. You'll find a couple of pictures here and there. You'll find a couple of glossed over things. But you can't really find out about Baphomet. It's the secret of secrets.
Yes. I mean, that's why, look, I've been working on this since 2005. When I was on the show previously, I talked about my Ouija boards experiences, yes. And that's really why I became obsessed with the subject, is because I got contacted by an entity calling himself Baphomet.
Right.
And I talked to him for years, and I really felt like I got to know him, and I really wanted to know, you know, what does it mean? Where did it come from? I did all this research, you know, since 2005. The reason why it's taken so long is because it's such a complicated subject, and that's the reason why I had to get someone to help me finally, Alexander Rivera, because I couldn't hold all the information that I needed to correlate in my mind all at once to write about it. It was just – it's so confusing, and I almost think this is deliberate, not only on the part of the occultists that have written about it before. I think they're, you know, concealing their secrets, as you said. But even Baphomet himself, I think, is exerting an influence here. Like, he doesn't really want to be understood.
Yeah, absolutely. And if you are somebody that has that knowledge, and you are for real, you're never going to let that. You know, you're not going to tell anybody about it. No, that is going to be secret. That's it. That's the whole intention of it all. So what we know is only what has leaked out or filtered through. I mean, it is certainly what we know, and what you can find out on the internet is the watered down version of what is real.
Well, and then the version of the thing that everybody thinks they know about Baphomet is that he's the devil.
Right.
And you know, I'm not saying that's wrong. In fact, that's corroborated by our book entirely. But it's very simple, and that's what they want you to think. You know, they just want you to think, oh, that's the devil. The Freemasons worship the devil. Miley Cyrus worships the devil. And, that's,
right.
You know, they don't want you to think about anything beyond that, really, and how it's being utilized and what it actually means to them.
Now,
interestingly, I mean, the word Baphomet is more popular now than ever. You know, they've got the statue in Detroit. They've got these conspiracy theorists all over the internet analyzing the images in the background of the music videos, and they see Baphomet everywhere. So everyone's talking about it now, but I don't think that any of them know hardly anything about it.
Let's go to the other side, the other end of the casket, which this is one of the more graphic, well, they're all pretty graphic, but this is one of the more graphic images. Rita Post, it's crocodile, post crocodile. This is fascinating, and it is as dark as it is. It is an absolutely somebody carved this, Tracy. You know, somebody did this with bad intentions and carved this relief. And this is nuts. So let's start on the left hand side and let's work our way across. On what is, did I say across? Across. And Bob, it's going out on Twitter right now. It is also in the gallery for everybody, in the gallery. It is the first image on the third row. You can click on it there. So let's start on the left-hand side and work our way across on this image. It is disturbing.
Okay, I'm trying to follow along here. So we're talking about the one with the smaller, the looks like a child riding a crocodile?
Yep.
Okay. So Yeah. Well, that one, it just looks like you've got someone holding an axe, and there's an angel, and he or she is holding a wreath. There's someone kneeling down, looks like maybe kissing the buttocks of one of the other people. Then there's the next side. I think this one's a little bit more interesting. You've got a guy.
Well, hold on.
Spreading the.
Well, hold on. Yeah, before we go to that one, that one's pretty crazy too. But in this one, what is disturbing is the child is riding the back of this crocodile. He's holding the guy in the middle, holding his hand. And then you've got the guy standing in back of him with this axe in one hand, waving it in the air. And the other small child looks like he's on his knees doing something strange, also holding the guy's hand. So you've got the bad guy on the left with an axe. You've got the angel on the right. You've got the guy in the middle holding both child's hands. And it looks like the child on the left in front of the guy with the axe, like he's got some kind of anguish on his face, like he's pleading. That's what I think is going on here. It looks like something ominous is about to go down. And also the guy on the left with the axe, in one hand he's got the axe in his left hand, and in his right hand he's holding something. It looks like some type of weapon too in his other hand. And the angel,
I'm thinking that's maybe a shovel for some reason.
Yeah, it looks
like a shovel.
It does, which is even crazier. It looks shovel like. And then you have the angel. It's an obvious angel on the other side. So you've got this event is going down. What do you think the crocodile symbolizes here?
Well, you know, it could be any number of things. I mean, you know, in Egypt, they were sort of symbols of royalty, and the fat of the crocodiles was used as an oil to anoint the pharaohs and stuff. But and it could also just be, see, Hammer Perkstall thinks that's like sort of like the symbol of the dragon. And actually in a lot of Gnostic symbolism, even though you would think the dragon sort of symbolizes the devil and you might think that they would favor that character, in fact, they view dragons as representations of the demiurge, who's the god of the Bible, the god that created this world. So, and they see him as kind of an enemy. So Hammer Perkstall identified several of the images, like the crocodile. I think he identified that as an image of the demiurge. Also, there's lions in some of the images, and he said that that was the demiurge also. And so that could be it. And it could also just be, you know, if they were doing child sacrifices, maybe they, you know, were feeding maybe the crocodiles were involved in the sacrifice. Let's just put it that way.
Right, right.
And then there's also almost every animal that's depicted in Hammer Perkstall's images. There's at least one picture of them, you know, looks like having sex. So I don't know how you'd have sex with a crocodile, though. I mean, it doesn't seem like it would work, but I don't know.
Well, apparently the Knights Templar figured something out. The next image, the one that on the flip side that you were talking about, let me pull this up here. It's
when you think about Steve Irwin and, you know, the crocodile does the death roll. I mean, can you imagine how would that work? You know, how would you have sex while the crocodile is death rolling you? I mean, it just wouldn't work, but. I don't know. Go ahead. Sorry.
Well, you wanted to talk about the one that was on the flip side. Which image is that?
Well, I'm trying to go chronologically now through my article to the one that comes after that. So then there's this is another one of those end pieces. This shows the crocodile being. It looks like it's crawling into a large cauldron.
Right.
And there's someone pouring a jar of something over it. This is something you see on several of the sides of the coffers, is someone with a jar pouring something over someone else. This is like the baptism that we're talking about. And then to the left of that, there's a guy holding a pair of human legs in front of him. So you see his back, and you can see the spread legs that he's spreading in front of him. You don't see who the legs are attached to, but it's a person.
Right.
So he's involved in sex with somebody.
He's naked. You see his butt.
Yeah, he's naked. I think they're all. Most of these guys are naked. Yeah, some of them aren't, but yeah. most of them are naked. And they don't look. They look like little dwarf humans. They look demonic. They don't look like real people.
Yeah, like little trolls. Yeah, yeah.
So, and then to the right of the cauldron where the crocodile is crawling in, and there's a guy pouring water on a jar, and there's another guy also sort of holding the crocodile down. Well, both of those guys are kind of sticking their butts out to the right, and then to the right of that there's a guy actually reaching over, looks like kind of sticking his hand on or inside of the butt of this guy.
Yes
So, and then to the right of that there's three guys, and one of them is on top of an altar, and they're all fondling each other. So this is a total orgy scene here on this side.
It looks like all males. Yeah. It looks like they're trying to the guy on the altar. And again, if you have children in the room, cover their ears. It looks to me like they're almost raping that guy, like they're trying to hold him down, because they've got definitely got one of his arms is being held down, and the other guy is standing all the way to the right. It looks like he's almost pulling him back.
It does look like that. But then if you zoom in, you can almost see a facial expression on the guy on the altar, and it kind of looks like he's smiling. So I don't know if it's really rape.
Right. I don't want to zoom in. I'm gonna leave my – and it is a crazy, crazy scene. You've got three things going on here, three elements. On the right, you've got the guy with his back to you that he's got somebody's leg spread on the other side of him. And then in the middle, you've got this crocodile being put into this cauldron with a couple of guys. The one guy's bent over, and then he's got somebody reaching into his backside. That's obvious. And then you've got this scene with the three guys on the altar on the right. And it is a crazy scene. And when you first look at it, you may not understand what's really going on here. Then you kind of just take a second look. And that is a crazy, crazy scene. No females, too, also in this. It looks like it's all males.
Yeah, there's only a couple of figures that show up here that look like they might be females in this whole thing. Most of them are males. I want to apologize that I think I was looking at the wrong page when you were describing the bull sacrifice. So now I remember exactly what you're talking about. Yes, the first one of the first sides of the coffer here after the cover with the meat on it, it does in fact show what looks like a bull having its throat sliced right next to a burning cauldron. So I'm sorry that I missed that, because there is another image where you see a bull on an altar being worshipped. But you're right. There's also this one where they're actually killing it.
Yeah, that's what it looks like to me. And he's definitely got his hands around the bull's head, and it looks like that he could be cutting his throat. And then there's somebody riding the bull, too, as well. It looks like he's sitting on the back of the bull.
I know, yeah. Yeah, that's a strange way to do a sacrifice, for sure. Okay, so, yeah, and then you want to go on to the next one?
Yeah, let's go to, where are we? Okay, let's go past that one. Yeah, let's go to the opposite side with... I don't even know what, let me see what this one's called. This one is called, so everybody can see this in the right order. It's the one, it looks like somebody's holding up a tray full of stuff, and that's on the right. You've got somebody kneeling at Baphomet on the left, that his hand is up between his legs, fondling his manhood. That's kind of, that's the way it looks to me. I could be wrong.
This is a very, very Baphometic image too. I mean, it matches up very well with the later depictions of Baphomet. So this image alone probably influenced Levi quite a bit. because it's a goat-headed figure. He's got the horns.
Yes.
He's got steam breasts. And then, yeah, very pronounced testicles there. And those are being squeezed, and then the buttocks are being kissed by someone.
Mm-hmm.
And interestingly, actually, this is a very particular kind of idol. It's called a herm. They used to use them in ancient Greece for fertility. You would put them in your garden or your where your crops are to ward off trespassers, basically. Usually what it would be is it'd be a depiction of Hermes from the waist up, and then just a column from the waist down, but it would have an erect penis.
Right.
And then
right,
there would
right.
be a warning placard, on or around this statue that would say, warning to anyone who trespasses, Hermes, or sometimes it's also Priapus, will rape you if you come through this territory. So that's usually what herms were used for, is to warn people not to trespass on your property. And also the image was supposed to bring fertility to your crops. Well, so this looks very much like a herm in a lot of ways, because it's you don't see the legs. It's just a column on the, from the legs down, but you have the genitals. Which is fitting, because as I was kind of describing earlier, the symbolism of Hermes is part of the symbolism of Baphomet. So Baphomet is Hermes, but he's a larger concept than that too. Hermes is only a part of the concept of Baphomet.
And
but yeah, so you go ahead.
This statue, it's a statue of Baphomet too, because he doesn't have legs.
Exactly. Yeah, I'm saying it's like a Baphomet statue in the style of a herm.
Right. And so, moving from left to right, then there looks like there's a woman in a dress.
Yeah, so this is one of the few female figures you see. I mean, we can assume it's a female because the dress kind of looks feminine. But yes, and she's pouring water from a jar over two of the other guys that are kind of kneeling and kissing Baphomet. So this goes along with the idea that there's a baptism of wisdom ritual related to Baphomet that the Templars were doing. The ritual that they were specifically accused of, the most common aspect of the accusations and their confessions when they did confess it, they all said that we had to worship this idol, and then we had to kiss the buttocks of the person doing the initiation. And then there were variations on it too, like sometimes would have to kiss the backside of a goat or a cat. But this is something that came out even a few years ago. There was something called the Chinon parchment that the Vatican released. They supposedly found it all of a sudden in their secret archives. And it was another Templar trial that had happened besides the one that the King of France put on. The Pope himself also had his own trial for these guys, and they confessed the same things to him. And so we have actually in this parchment more detail of what they did, what their rituals were. And it's pretty much confirmed now. I mean, I'm not even sure I believe that this document is real, but for historians think that it is, that the Vatican said that it is, so they kind of take them at their word.
Right.
And so even the Vatican is saying for sure they were kissing each other's buttocks during these rituals. And it's strangely, Pope Clement supposedly, according to this document, absolved them. He forgave them for that. The way that the Vatican is spinning it now is that, oh, these are just sort of, hazing rites and pranks, and it's no big deal. but not only were they kissing each other's buttocks, but they were spitting on the cross. That's another detail that's in that document released by the Vatican. And they had a policy when you join the Templars that you have to swear never to have sex with women again. And a lot of these knights that joined already had families, so they had to abandon their families and swear not to have sex with women. Not chastity, mind you. They were sort of taking a vow of chastity, But then even as they're taking the vow, the person giving the vow to them says, well, if you can't keep the vow, just, you know, if you get caught with a prostitute or something, just don't make sure none of the other brothers know, because, you know, then it will lower their morale. But also what would really be better, and this is what they confess to, would be if you would just, you know, release your urges with each other. And so part of the vow that these guys would take when they would join is actually that they would not refuse their brother's advances if one of their brothers needed some sexual release. So it's hard for me to believe this happened. And according to the Chinon parchment, they confessed this stuff to the cardinals that the Pope sent, and he absolved them, said, oh, well, you know, do some Hail Marys and we'll get over it. And part of the reason why he wanted to do that, supposedly, because he was really anxious to reform the order and have them conglomerated with the Knights Hospitaller, which is another group, so that he could have another crusade. So he wanted to send these guys who were kissing each other's butts and denying Christ and spitting on the cross when they join their order. He wants to send them to go fight the Muslims who actually believe in Jesus and the virgin birth and all of those things. You know, the Muslims were more Christian than the Templars were. And he wanted to go send them into battle again. It's so funny.
And you could get, Tracy, you can get anybody to confess to anything if you're torturing them. And certainly on that Friday the 13th, when they were looking at not only being arrested, but, you know, being burned to death and the torture that was involved, you can get them to confess to anything, couldn't you? And why should we trust what the Vatican said as they extracted these confessions under extreme duress?
Well, according to the book that came out by the lady that found this stuff in the Vatican archives, and she works for them, by the way, and has been an employee since 2001. So take that for what you will.
Right.
But she puts it, she says there's no evidence that, that the Pope's trial involved torture. And in fact, the way she tells it, the Templar leaders that the Pope was interrogating at one point, recanted the confessions they had given to the King of France, to his police. And Jacques de Molay, the Grand Master, even said, well, we were lying because we were being tortured. And he came out in public right in front of Notre Dame Cathedral. There was a crowd there, and he took his shirt off and showed everyone the wounds where he had been tortured. And so the story goes that the Pope knew that they were being tortured. He knew they were being given, you know, sort of a bad deal, and he knew that they were also kind of guilty. So he wanted to get the real story and be able to, you know, find some way of reintegrating them back into the church, you know, so get them to confess what they really did without torture, and then, you know, work through it, you know, the way that you do in the church, give them what they're supposed to do for penance, and then forgive them and bring them back into the church. Well, so, you know, I'm not sure if I believe it, because the way that the church is putting it out now, it's like they want to make themselves look good. And they also want to make it look like the Templars weren't that bad. But everything that they're saying sort of contradicts that idea, because they're very much admitting that they're, you know, they were denying Christ and spitting on the cross. And they're very much admitting that they were involved in these homosexual acts. So, which, you know, of course, we take that quite differently now. Most people, I guess, or at least a large percentage of the population, doesn't think there's anything wrong with that. But at the same time, it was, for one thing, you know, obviously it was in a different context back then. And for another thing, it's part of this institution where, you know, it's not like a bunch of consenting adults doing this. You know, it's people joining a group that they think is a Catholic military order. And then they're sort of forced to do these things when they join. And there were even people as young as 11 years old being inducted into the Templars, and they were being given these same instructions. So, right, you know, I mean, right, there's just right. no way to make it look nice. And but I think that that's what the church has been doing for the last few years. They're trying to find some way to make it look like they didn't do anything wrong to the Templars, and the Templars weren't that bad, because of course the Templars were a product of the church. They came out of the church.
That's right. And what there's another angle here too as well, by trying to what Hammer Perkstall and Wright tried to do, and Levi too as well, tried to tie the Templars and the Freemasons directly together. And if the Templars were doing this, and they are integrated into the Freemasons, which is also secretive, to society, that if the Knights Templar were doing this, and that means the Freemasons are now bad too as well. And that was the propaganda that was spreading around in the early 1800s.
Yeah. Well, I don't know. I like there's no evidence really that the Freemasons as an institution are involved in anything like this. I mean,
well, I'm saying. You know, that's what I'm saying. They tried to intentionally tie the two of them together.
Yes. Well, and it's interesting though too. Okay, no one's saying that the Freemasons are doing anything like this, but why do the Freemasons want to connect themselves to the Templars? Why do so many modern occult groups want to connect themselves to the Templars? It's like this is the point of origin for the entire Western occult tradition. They all trace themselves back to the Templars and say that they're somehow continuing their tradition.
Right.
But this is a weird question. This is strange, because what do we know about the Templars and what their tradition was? Virtually nothing. What is it? Kissing people's butts? I mean, is that the tradition? How could that can't be it? So, so if the Freemasons are continuing a tradition from the Templars, what exactly is it, and how did they ever know what it was in the first place? And so, it's got to be the only way that could possibly happen is, and this is in fact what historians say is, well, there were a few families from the Templars that had been, you know, had been involved generation after generation in the Templars. And when they got disbanded, these families moved to Scotland, and that's where Freemasonry began and sort of, you know, the traditions continued from there. But what people tend to do now, and in fact, this is what we had to do a lot of times too, is, you know, you try to figure out what the Templars might have been involved with and what they might have thought based on what some of the organizations today are doing. And, you know, if they claim they come from the Templars, what, you know, you try to reverse engineer how could their traditions that they have now have come from that?
Right.
And we've done that a little bit. I mean, there's some use, some value in doing that. We've gotten some answers from doing that, but it's still very much an open question, you know. A lot of what we've come up with is very interesting, but it's not like there's that many primary sources here. You know, there's not like a real book of rituals of the Templars that's ever been published. So
right.
you just got to guess, basically. And it's so, yeah, you got to wonder then, too, if the only thing that's known for sure about the Templars is that they're spinning on the cross and kissing each other's butts, why do the Freemasons really want to connect themselves to this so much? I don't know.
Back to this image before we're heading to a break here in a couple of minutes. In the middle, there is somebody riding, it looks like the back of a goat or a lamb, maybe. And then to the right, and he's reaching up to and is holding something. I'll let you describe that. Then you have another guy that's on his knees that's holding up a plate or some type of, you know, something with a bunch of objects. And what is going on in that on the right side of the casket?
Well, it looks to me like you've got a guy holding up a tray full of vessels. They could be water vessels. I also thought they kind of look like alchemical vessels that are used in alchemical processes. Athanors, they're called.
Right.
But anyway, so he's got this tray that he's holding up with all these bottles on it. And then Well, okay, so there's like there's a guy that's standing and holding the tray, and then beneath him there's another guy supporting it. And so it kind of looks like not only is the guy underneath supporting the tray, but he's right there, you know, underneath, you know.
Yes.
He's in front of this guy's genitals, basically, with his face in front of them. So.
Right, right.
Yeah, it kind of looks like that.
And then.
So, yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, over on the far right, what's the last guy doing?
Well, he kind of looks like maybe an angel because he kind of looks like he has wings, but he also has talons on his feet.
Right.
And he's got a crown. So I'm thinking that this is some kind of either demon or angel or God or something. Some sort of supernatural figure there.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely amazing. Now let's go to the fraud coffer. But it definitely, as I look at these, it looks to me like it's the same artist. The way
it is.
Yeah, it does. It looks like the same artist because the cauldrons are the same. The way that the flames are, certainly the faces and the body structures are the same. And let's go to, I'll have this image posted. It's called Flaming Bowl and Sticks, Rita, if you could post this one. Again, it's disturbing. Oh, what were you able to decipher what is written on the tapestry that's hanging in the background?
No, and my husband is fluent Arabic, so I mean, no, we weren't able to decipher it at all. He says it doesn't really make much sense. Hammer Pergstall said that these things aren't straightforward at all. So you have to first decode the letters, you know, it's Arabic letters, but then the words themselves might be Greek, or in fact, you might have to transpose the letters in order to find the Greek message in there. So there's several layers of coding to these things. And no, I was not able to figure it out. The other thing my husband said, and this corresponds to what the other authors on the subject have said, is that the letters don't look like they've been written by someone who knew very well how to write Arabic. So for one thing, I sure don't think Hammer Pergstall faked these, because I'm sure he knows how to write Arabic, or did. But whoever made these didn't. But that doesn't mean anything either. Okay, so because it could be a forger in the 1700s, like so many people think, or it could have been, you know, during the Templar era. Either way, you know, it's not uncommon at all for, you know, Westerners trying to execute a foreign language in writing to do it badly. So, you know, maybe the Templars made this, but they just weren't very good at writing Arabic.
Your description here, I'm going to read it. It says, we see... okay, hold on. Let me back up here. It says, to the left, we see a person stirring a cup in one hand with a large stick in the other. In front of him, another person kneels and fondles him. To their right, another man is pointing a stick to his right over the head of another man who seems to be having sex with a hooved creature, the details of which are hard to make out beyond the bent hind legs. Whilst he mounts the animal, he is simultaneously stirring a bowl that sits on the ground with a large pole. The bowl has an object sticking out of it that may be a small child standing, and the animal's front paws and arms are on his head. To the right of this, another man is kneeling over the bowl and reaching up over his head to the right to grasp what he looks like is an alchemical vessel by the neck, holding it over the flames of a brazier, which sits on the ground to his right. To the right, another man holds out his left hand and grasps the vessel by the neck as well. Over this, the two men holding it, there is a banner tacked to the wall with a message in Arabic. The look of this banner and the entire scene as well makes it clear that this piece, fake or not, was made by the same artist, and I agree with that, that made the coffer with the orgy scenes featured in Pergstall's book. The poorly written...
Okay, and correction. It wasn't actually featured in Pergstall's book. I need to correct that. It was featured in Thomas Wright's book, but Pergstall wrote about it.
Right. and the poorly written Arabic letters on the banner are of the same style. And it, I thought it was the same, too, by the way, when I first looked at it. So I go and I read your description in the article. I haven't seen the picture yet. And I'm like, holy crap, what kind of scene is this? You know, you're reading it, and then you go down, and now that I've done this for the audience, now you can understand a bit more clearly what's going on. And this one is picture number one in the second row of the gallery. It has been posted in Twitter, too, as well, and I just retweeted it. Now, let's go back to the image, now that I've given the description. That is indeed what is going on here. There's a lot of action. There's a lot of stirring. There's a lot of cauldrons. There's a lot of chemicals. Nobody is dressed in this scene. And it's action-filled from left to right.
Yeah, and definitely this time I think the vessel is an alchemical vessel because it's got such a long neck. That's really the only place that I've seen an object like that before. And they're heating it over a fire, so, you know. And then the reason why I said that that object sticking up out of the bowl might be a small person is because that's an image that is repeated a few times in the collection of Hammer Perkstall's images. He's got a picture of a boy literally standing in a flaming cauldron. And then there's other pictures from other places that depict someone literally, you know, pushing or, you know, kind of forcing a boy to stand in a cauldron that's flaming. So, and this matches up with something that specifically the Templars were accused of. And then later, Gnostic group called the Waldensians were accused of the same thing, something called the baptism of fire. And it's literally, you know, immolating a child and then using the ashes afterwards for a communion.
Let's we blew right past the break. Let me get this break in.
And sorry about that.
And no, that's me. That's all me. You're the guest tonight, Tracy Twyman. We're discussing these the images on these Knight Templar caskets over at the British Museum. More with Tracy Twyman when we come back. Stay with us.
Hi, everybody. This is Rob Halford, the Metal God, on JimmyChurchRadio.com.
KGRA Radio. Intelligent talk.
Are you a paranormal investigator, ghost hunter, or UFO skywatcher? If so, FNGinnovations.com has the product you definitely need in your investigations kit or go bag. Introducing the Morpholite Wide Beam Tactical Flashlights that put the light where you need it most. Traditional flashlights shine a focused round beam with limited line of sight in the dark. Morpholite Tactical Flashlights change all that, utilizing a revolutionary wide beam design to enable you to see safety hazards such as hanging wires and steel, pipes, and holes in the floor you just can't see with a focused round beam. In the field, where safety is paramount, a 180-degree beam increases orientation and peripheral vision in the dark. Morpholite flashlights are ideal for investigations in abandoned facilities such as houses and hospitals, factories, caves, and tunnels. Avoid those low-hanging tree branches that poke your eyes in the woods. Visit FNGinnovations.com to see a full line of tactical lights and accessories. That's FNGinnovations.com.
Now you can find all your favorite talk radio shows live, all in one place at TalkStreamLive.com. Listen from anywhere, office, home, or in your car. Just go to TalkStreamLive.com and click on one of the many live talk show hosts you want to listen to. It's free and easy. No computer? Download the smartphone apps. Never miss your favorite talk show. Find them all at TalkStreamLive.com.
You want to know a secret? I love ponies. I really love ponies. I'm serious. I couldn't stay sane without ponies to brush.
Why fade to black? Because you never got that pony. Damn it.
This is Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
Welcome back to Fade to Black. Tonight, Tracy Twyman is with us. We're talking about her article. It's called Found Again, The Templar Artifacts of Hammer Purgstall. You can read the article over on her website. We have posted the links to it. And her new book is Baphomet, The Mystery of Mysteries Unveiled. And Tracy, I just got, it just came in again. Is this true or is this just a smear campaign?
You mean that's an email you got?
Yep.
Okay. Well, you mean, is it a smear campaign on the part of Hammer Purgstall?
Yes, exactly.
Maybe? I don't know.
Yeah, yeah.
That's what we're trying to figure out, but I don't think so because it doesn't seem to fit with the character of him, you know, historically. But he could have been duped, I suppose, by someone else who had that intention.
Well, it's
certainly not a smear campaign for me. I mean, I have
No. I guess, you know, when you think about the way that Hammer Purgstall wrote the book and how he wrote it, and he was trying to, it's always about the evidence, right? And he's trying to back it up. He's got all of these other objects. By the way, I want to get into that part of it too as well, the other objects that we need to chase down and what those are. So let's get to that in a second. But, sure. I mean, could this, you know, just been a smear campaign on Hammer's part? Because as much as it doesn't fit him, because he was a respected guy, he was a respected author of the time. But but as much as it doesn't fit his persona, it doesn't fit what the Knights Templar were all about and their participation in the Crusades and Christianity and the Temple Mount and you know, Solomon's treasure and the artifacts and the True Cross and the Holy Grail and everything that they were about. That they, you know, history has portrayed them as being, you know, great guys. You know, they've never been portrayed as raping pedophiles. You know what I mean? And that's the part that is confusing here. So could it have been a smear campaign on Hammer's part for whatever reason?
Well, yes, it could have. But as far as this not fitting the reputation of the Templars, actually it does because, yes, on the one hand, they had a reputation for having a very ascetic lifestyle, adhering to very strict oaths of, you know, supposedly poverty and chastity and other things. Like, you know, they weren't allowed to flee the battle if they were outnumbered. They had to fight to the death and things like that. And they did perform very well in the first few Crusades and then were blamed by some people for losing other Crusades. But it does fit with their reputation because, like I was just saying, in the end, they did confess to having another side, having an inner doctrine and secret rituals. So, I mean, we know they have had secret rituals, and it's just a matter of trying to figure out if there's more detail that we can find of what their rituals were and why they were doing it. And so that's what my book is largely about, trying to figure out what that might have been, what those what that secret doctrine was. So it does fit. And in fact, we found more evidence that, you know, they definitely had a secret doctrine. They produced seals, actually, that they would use to seal documents. And these exist. These have been found, and one of them is in the French National Archives. Another one is in the British Museum. And these seals feature Abraxas, who's a Gnostic deity. And like Baphomet, it's another chimera. So it's part human, but it's got snakes for legs. It's called an anguipede because it's got snakes for legs. And then he's got a chicken head, a male human torso, chicken head, and snakes for legs. That's called Abraxas. And we spent a whole chapter on the subject of Abraxas, how it is very similar, actually, in its meaning to Baphomet, and it could have been just another way of expressing the same idea. So definitely the Templars were aware to some extent of Gnosticism and Gnostic ideas. And not only aware of them, but they identified themselves with it. In fact, this seal that has the picture of Abraxas on it also says around the edges, it says secret of the temple in Latin. So it's like Abraxas is the secret of the Temple of Solomon that they named themselves after. and it definitely indicates a secret doctrine of a Gnostic bent. And also Abraxas isn't just a Gnostic deity, but he's also associated with ritual magic tradition. So again, he's sometimes viewed as the force that makes a magical transformation happen. And he's viewed as like the basic force of fertility in the world, and sort of the force that the different polarities of the world come out of. So this is like what you would get if you put, you know, male and female and good and evil together in the same entity. It would be this entity that sort of transcends good and evil and male and female polarities. That's what Baphomet symbolizes. That's also what Abraxas symbolizes. And the Templars were using that as their official seal and saying that's the secret of their temple. So that's just one piece of evidence that we found. So much more that, yeah, they did have a secret doctrine.
Yeah.
They were maybe Christians to some level, but what kind of Christians and what did that mean to them?
Yeah. And, you know, the image out there for the Knights Templar for most is one view. I'm looking at some of the comments here in Twitter. Stallone just said, are you sure that this data wasn't left from a group at war with the Templars? Seems like they were trying to disrespect the Templars. And then Spiritual Warrior, he says, so does she have a timeline of the start or the near of inception of the Templar activity, you know, referring to this. And then somebody else tweeted, maybe these images are initiation rites, that maybe some of this is depicting that, what they actually went through in an initiation. I thought that was a pretty good observation. So I guess you understand what I'm saying. The modern way of looking at the Knights Templar, certainly, you know, the Hollywood depiction and so forth. This is conflicting so greatly with that. Did you have one view of the Knights Templar, and as you did this research over the years, did your view change?
Well, only a little bit, because from the beginning of my research, I sort of understood that they did have a secret occult doctrine. So I've known that for a while, and had known some evidence of that for a while, and it just grew and grew as we did more and more research. But even again, the Chinon parchment and the stuff that has been written about that by the woman who found it.
Right.
She said that according to their confessions, this this initiation rite that involved, you know, denying Christ, spitting on the cross, and kissing buttocks, and also swearing that you'll have homosexual sex with your brothers, all that stuff, she said, goes back almost to the beginning. Again, according to their confessions, that this is a tradition that, you know, was already several hundred years old by the time they finally got arrested. So, a lot of people had theorized, well, maybe they only got into this stuff at the end after it had the original tradition had degenerated for a while. But no, apparently the secret rule had been in existence for a while. And there's a document that claims to be the secret rule, something called the Book of the Baptism by Fire. This is you could have another whole book about this, because this thing needs to be translated too. And it's very hard to find. So, but let's just say that some people have written about that. We kind of know a little bit about what's in it. And it also, you know, the evidence is that this secret rule has been around since almost the beginning, and it is a description of these types of rites, including this baptism by fire that involves burnt offering of a child. So you might think it conflicts with the reputation of the Knights Templar, but then actually once you start looking at what the reputation is, it doesn't. You know, it's just the popular perception is different. But the popular perception has been influenced very much by, you know, these Holy Grail books, you know, like Holy Blood, Holy Grail itself, and also other books that, you know, are about the mysteries of the Holy Grail, the mysteries of Freemasonry, you know, the Ark of the Covenant, where is it now? And, you know, they're trying to make this the Freemasons look, or the Templars look interesting, and which they are. And also, you know, they've always sort of presented it as though they're victims, that they were wrongly accused, they were persecuted, they're victims of torture, you know, they're victims of the church. You know, the church is, you know, has so many skeletons in its closet, it's not hard to believe that at all, that they persecuted these people wrongly, and certainly that the King of France persecuted them wrongly because he owed them a lot of money and he was jealous that they wouldn't let him in the order when he asked them to. But this part of it too is that it's just been romanticized, you know, and it's been associated with things like worship of the sacred feminine and, you know, all these sort of new age ideas that people get into now.
Right.
Which I'm not knocking those ideas. I'm just saying a lot of people want to find some sort of ancient provenance for those traditions and they attach it to the Templars. Now, okay, it's not, they're not totally wrong in that they were worshiping this, apparently, you know, possibly this goddess figure, this Sophia or Meat. But I still think that goddess figure is not at all what people are envisioning when they talk about, you know, the goddess, the sacred feminine principle. It's something a lot more sinister.
With when Friday the 13th rolled around and these accusations were there and the confessions came, and without any evidence coming forward, is this at the point where this needs to be discussed with another, you know, another tonality to it, where that there may have been, instead of, you know, persecution and they were accused of stuff that wasn't true, that now we need to start discussing that maybe these seeker doctrines and the activities that were going on with the Knights Templar, that there was actually something to this and we need to have another discussion.
Well, definitely we do, but it's interesting. I think that all the interested parties, everyone who might have some evidence to present on this question, is keeping their mouths shut. So you've got maybe Freemasons, perhaps supposedly continuing the traditions of the Templars. Well, they're not answering the question clearly in any of their literature. And then you've got the Church putting out what I have described as apologia on the subject of the Templars, trying to make themselves look good, trying to make the Templars look good.
Right.
So, and okay, and then you mentioned that we need to talk about all the other artifacts. Well, if Bergstall was telling the truth, if Hammer Bergstall really found these objects, then that means that there's dozens of idols of this this creature with a beard and breasts and sometimes horns, and a bunch of other aspects that are very interesting, sometimes covered with eyeballs all over the body,
right?
Sometimes covered with the sun and the moon and astral figures all over the body, sometimes with multiple eyes and noses and mouths on the same face. All these idols, where are they? I mean, did someone destroy them? Or are they in, you know, the house of some rich person in Europe somewhere whose family has been keeping it all this time? And, you know, what do those people know and what do they have to hide?
Exactly.
This is what I wonder. I mean, if these things exist, I frankly doubt if they were destroyed. It could be that some of them were destroyed by priests who – this is what Hammer Perkstall says. Some of the things were defaced because the priests that, you know, were in these churches in his time in the 1800s, you know, they found all these pictures of naked people having sex and stuff, and they just sort of whitewashed it or carved, you know, chipped away at the carvings. Or it took the idols and hid them in the basement because they didn't want their parishioners to see this stuff. But so it, maybe some of it disappeared that way. But I'll bet a lot of it was just sucked up by rich people who, you know, wanted to have these things or knew what they were in the first place and wanted to hide them. And I think it's only because the Duke de Blacas wanted to tell people about them that we know about any of them.
Do you think that Lincoln or Lynn Picknell or any of the other authors that wrote about not only the Knights Templar, but that entire South of France thing and Jesus, that they had known about this information and they just chose not to write about it in their books? Because that certainly would have changed the perception throughout our generation, because their books certainly influenced us into another frame of mind when it came to not only the Knights Templar, but the genealogy going back to Mary and Jesus.
Yeah, I don't know if these guys looked at the document itself. I'm sure the people that you described, have read about it. Maybe they looked at it. Most likely they sort of dismissed it, because that's the way it's been treated, not during Fergusol's time, but a few decades afterwards, when people were writing about him, they sort of poo-pooed him and just said that, he was, when they're being generous, they just say that he was kind of naive and believed all this stuff.
Right.
When they're being mean, they say that he's part of a right-wing conspiracy.
Right.
So I wouldn't doubt if some of the other authors just didn't delve very much into it because it had been so dismissed by previous authors. But what I found is that it doesn't look like most of these previous authors have actually read it. And I think it's simply because it was in Latin. And when you read what they wrote about what the book supposedly says, it doesn't match up. They keep saying that it's a political treatise, and it's not. There's nothing political in it. So I think that maybe most of these people were just reading about it, not actually reading it.
The opposite side of the fake casket is the guy in the cauldron. And your description here is as somebody being baptized. And I can understand that at first impression. That's kind of what's going on. But I don't see that here. In this, I think that guy is dead. That looks like the way that his arms are hanging. It looks like they're pulling him out of it. He's been cooked. That's
wow.
Yeah, that guy looks dead. He does not look alive. He doesn't look like he's happy. He doesn't look like he's being baptized. It looks like a limp body that's being pulled out of a cauldron.
So you think maybe they either burned him or drowned him, and now they're pulling him out?
Yeah, yeah, that's the way that looks to me.
Then why are they pouring the water over his head, though, or pouring the jar?
Maybe trying to revive him?
I don't know.
Yeah, yeah, I'm serious. That's the way it looks to me. And then you've got the owl. What's the owl doing there?
Well, it's looking at the viewer like,
yeah,
as though you just walked in on something, where'd you come from?
Totally. But, he looks dead. He doesn't look like he's being baptized. I think that is somebody being pulled out. Look at his arms, and it just looks like, that's the way it looks to me. And I think it's shocking. The first time that I saw it, I read your description, so I'm looking for the happy baptism, right? But that's not what's going on there. That looks like a dead guy being pulled out of a cauldron. And I wanted to ask the audience in Twitter that just got posted, this image. Does that look like a baptism, or does that look like a dead guy being pulled out that he's just been boiled? And let's see what Twitter has to say about that.
All right.
And let's go to the next one. We're going to be hitting up against a break, and I want to get the rest of these images in. So let's go to this is it's the wrong word to say. This is one of my favorites, but the bull on the altar.
Okay,
I
jumped the gum earlier when I described this, but yeah, you got a bull on an altar. You've got someone putting a garland probably over his head, people kneeling in front of him, and then there's like a...
Oh, we lost...
To inflate a bonfire at some point.
We lost what you said right after bull. Okay, so go ahead. Full description again.
Okay, so bull is on an altar. There's people kneeling in front of the altar. There's someone about to put a garland on the bull's neck. There's what looks like an equilateral cross floating over the whole scene, and someone's pointing at it.
Right.
And then that person is also holding an ankh, kind of, but it's also like a tau or a T symbol. These are mystical symbols. And, of course, the equilateral cross was used by the Templars, so that maybe it's a Templar cross, or is meant to be, at any rate. But yeah, it looks like the worshiping the bull, but also there's a billows at the bottom of the altar that looks like it's about to be used to ignite a fire. So they may be worshiping him now, and they may be sacrificing him later on, is the way I took it.
I wonder how, with bellows like that, when did those come along? You know, because we were talking about dating these, you know, you and I were talking about that and looking at it. That is one object that could possibly be dated. And what is behind the bellows?
I don't know. It looks like a drum, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah. Just a crazy scene. And the guy on his knees, he's obviously pointing at the altar and the bull. The other guy's definitely on the left. He's definitely kneeling with his hands in a prayer position. He is definitely doing that. Then the guy behind him with the stick in his hand, that looks like he's in a weird position. The one that with the garland, that, what a crazy, so much action. And I do agree that is an ankh. That when you first look at that, that's exactly what that looks like.
There's a whole bunch of those in the Pergstall images of people holding this tau with a loop on top. So, yeah, it's an ankh or a tau, and it shows up all over the place. He thinks that is also a symbol of meat.
Yeah, and if you're going to do something incriminating, I mean, they're definitely, you know, worshiping their own god here. That's exactly what's going on, and they're definitely sacrificing, and they're getting ready to light up a fire.
And then they do. The last image is a guy being burned on an altar, as I described earlier. So,
yeah, let's we'll discuss this last one over the break. This one is about as dramatic as it gets, and somebody in Twitter is going to let this one slip out. Let's go ahead and take our last break tonight. Tracy Twyman, her article, and you can find it and go to it. It's called Found Again. You can find it on her website. TracyTwyman.com. The article is called Found Again, The Templar Artifacts of Hammer Pergstall. Her new book is Baphomet, The Mystery of Mysteries Unveiled. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. More with Tracy Twyman right after this. Stay with us.
To my boy, Jimmy Church, on JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Despite popular opinion, reading a book will not make you smarter.
But listening to Jimmy Church will.
All right, you fade or not, Studio Dome has done it once again. A new Studio Dome Fade or Not special. Introducing the Studio Dome Boom Box Bluetooth Speaker. It's got a rear-firing bass film subwoofer and dual 52-millimeter main speakers. You'll never listen to your tablet or cell phone speakers again. Just click on the Studio Dome banner, use the promo code Jimmy, and you'll get the SBB for $49 and free shipping. And get a Buddy 4-port USB charger for free. That's a $19.99 value right there. And they'll throw in a Buddy in the box. It's the best deal on the net. Anywhere. Just go to JimmyChurchRadio.com, click on the Studio Dome banner, enter the promo code Jimmy, go Beckley Teppy.
It's not a lifestyle we chose. We were born this way. KGRARadio.com.
This is KJCR at JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Welcome back to Fade to Black. Tonight, Tracy Twyman discussing her article, found again, The Templar Artifacts of Hammer Purge Stall, and her new book. It'll be available this Friday. Pre-orders for sure. Baphomet, The Mystery of Mysteries Unveiled. Tracy, I just got a couple of more questions in, and before we get to this last panel on the casket, a couple of things I want to throw out there to you. Do you think that this is where the saying kiss my ass, kiss the ass came from? Interesting take. Yes.
It definitely has to do with this, what they call osculum inflamme, which is means the obscene kiss. It was a term that was used, a Latin term, to refer to this ritual kiss. This is what the Templars were accused of. And like I said, witches also were accused of doing this at the witches' Sabbat. And so many of them confessed to it. And you can find so many woodcuts depicting the witches' Sabbat. And it shows people kissing the devil on his behind. And they actually, some of the witches described it, they said that the devil has another face underneath his tail. And that his favorite initiates, his favorite witches, he would let them kiss him on the mouth, but everyone else had to kiss him on the other mouth. So definitely the term kiss my ass came from the confessions of witches and the accusations against the Templars. For sure, that's totally what it means. And it's funny that this seems to be one of the aspects of Templar ritual that actually did survive into Freemasonry, because the Shriners, which is a Masonic group, they have in their initiation ceremony a point at which you are told to kiss the black stone of the Kaaba, because it's a ritual where you pretend that you're going to the Kaaba in Mecca. Mm-hmm. And there's a black stone where the Muslims typically kiss during
right.
their Hajj.
Right.
Well, they go through this pantomime where they pretend to do that. And then at the end, they tell the initiate that he's essentially kissed ass by doing that. They make him do it, and they make fun of him afterwards for doing it.
Oh.
Well, this is what the Templars did. In their rituals, they would have someone kiss someone's behind, and then afterwards they would make fun of him for it and tell him he had to confess it to a priest. So it's interesting that, you know, I was wondering, you know, what part of the Templar tradition survived in Freemasonry? Well, that part did. I mean, oddly enough, that
right.
aspect that seems so crude actually is part of the tradition that survived.
And hence the demeaning part, the humiliating part of it. And, you know, you were just kissing his ass, right?
Exactly.
I totally
exactly.
get it. It will never mean the same thing to me again after tonight's show. What about the Age of Taurus? And the depictions of, well, that's one of the questions that came up, is part of this with you know, all of the bull sacrifices here. Does it have anything to do with the Age of Taurus?
I don't think so, or I haven't come across anything like that. That's not part of my theory, I guess.
Okay. Let's get to this last panel, which is certainly the most graphic, which is, I'll hand it off to you. The way that you've written it here, you know what, let me read this really quick. You say, finally, on the last side of the box, a man is slumped backwards as if dead, been placed on a flaming brick altar on top of some logs while two men lift up their hands in worship towards an unseen god. As crazy as that sounds, that's exactly what's going on here, isn't it?
Yes. And now, see, you're helping me out here, Jimmy, because now I'm putting it all together. If that guy in the other image, the baptism, as I called it, is actually dead, maybe that's them killing him, and then on the other side, they dispose. That could be what's going on here. And definitely, they're lifting up their hands. It looks like, you know, as though they're praising Jesus at church, but clearly they're not. It definitely looks like an act of worship. They're not just disposing of a body, you know, that they accidentally killed. It's a ritual sacrifice as part of a religious ceremony of some sort.
It's
very disturbing.
Well, you just made me go back and look, and it looks like
The same guy?
All three are the same. Yes.
Yep.
And if you look, interesting.
I mean, if you look at all four of these sides, it looks like they're all connected. They're all depicting the same ritual.
Interesting. Interesting. I'm flipping back and forth now. They definitely look like the same two guys. And yes.
I'm wondering what was on the lid, because we don't have the lid of this casket.
Right, right.
I mean, it must have been something interesting. Maybe it was another meat.
Did you Did you ask the British Museum if there was if they could go and look for a lid? Did they ever get it? Was it inventory? Do they know?
I have not asked them specifically that yet. I'll tell you the truth, Jimmy. I did write a letter with some questions in it. I haven't gotten a response yet, but it has taken several months each time when I write to this particular department to get a response.
Right.
So I could get someone later. I didn't get that aggressive about it. I could have called them on the phone and really pushed, and maybe I will do that now. But in the last few months, I really didn't want to alert them too much to what I was studying.
Right.
You know, I could tell as I kept buying the rights to pictures and having them take photos for me. And I could tell that they knew I was interested in these things that I assume no one else has looked at in probably 150 years. So I was just afraid, actually. It's just the conspiracy theorist in me was thinking, I don't want them to know what I'm onto in case the objects just suddenly disappear or become damaged. You know, I would hate for that to happen. So I wanted to get this whole thing written and in the bag before I told the British Museum what I thought these things were. And so I'm going to do that now. I don't think I have anything to lose.
No, you got.
But I really wanted to play it safe.
You got the photographs. You got that, right? You got the photographs.
Yeah.
So now you can get a little stronger. I did go back and look. The owl is only in that one image too as well. So that was the other thing. And on the other side of the casket, because on one side you've got, you know, the guy being burned. And then on the other side, it's the same objects there. In other words, you have the brick. I don't know what you would call it, the brick box that he's being burnt on, that's also on the other side of the casket, but the cauldron isn't there and the owl isn't there. But it's almost the same scene from another perspective.
I kept calling it an altar because, you know, you got a guy being burned alive on it on one, or being maybe dead, being burned on one side. It looks like it's a burnt offering. And then on the other one, there's on the other casket, there's a similar one, actually. There's the guy sitting on it, and the other two guys are fondling him.
Yes.
He's also sitting on a little brick thing.
Yes.
So I think it's an altar. That's what I would call it.
Yeah, I'm looking at that one right now, too. Yeah, this is it's pretty interesting, and it's pretty graphic. I'm going to go back now and try to look at those in sequence, like 1, 2, 3, 4. To see if there's some connection, but it definitely looks like it's the same three guys on both sides on the ends. Very interesting. Oh yeah, before we get I almost forgot. What were the other objects that Hammer Bergstahl had referred to that you are you should try to go and find?
Well, so there were more coffers. There were probably a dozen or more idols that he has pictures of, and I'm assuming statues. And then there were lots of coins, including coins that have known Gnostic talismans on them. And then there's lots of wall decorations, you know, frescoes, bas-reliefs, things like that. So there's things on the walls of churches, and those are probably, I think, actually the most likely to have been demolished at this point. If we can't find the churches anymore, you know, then the wall decorations may have just been gone, you know. But the objects, the physical objects that are free-floating, like statues and coins, I'll bet you they're still around. And frankly, I wouldn't doubt if a lot of them have been preserved in the private collections of wealthy people who know what they are. That's what I think. But maybe we'll get lucky and find them in some other museum somewhere in Europe. So that would be cool. And Now, if we can get the images a bit more popular, get some other researchers on the scene, people in Europe just go to their local museums, start looking for these things. Maybe someone will stumble upon them. Or maybe I can find another clue in some of the contemporary writings from the 19th century that will tell me where some of these places, where some of these things ended up. But so far, the only clue I could find really was this, the clue about the stuff in the British Museum. And that panned out really well. So I hope I find some more clues, or somebody does.
A couple of comments here that have flown by on Twitter. The two figures with the cauldron look like they could possibly be female and the dead guy male. Do you get
I don't think so. Because you can see the same guys, from different angles when you look at the other pictures. And most of them look like short, squat males. Some of them have big bellies, so I can see why you might think they look
right.
You know, like they have feminine curves. But I think they look like, most of them look like little demon men.
Now, somebody made a comment. Dennis says in the cauldron picture that one of the two figures looks like he's tattooed. And I'm trying to see what he is referring to there. I don't know. And then, I'm trying to see it. You know, it's kind of hard to make out. But then in the fire picture, for some reason, the one with the back to you with his arms raised up in the air, both arms are raised, it almost looks like he has a ponytail. Is that just the way that the carving is done? It's kind of weird. Could that be long hair?
Oh, I see what you're saying. I suppose. I'll have to look at – I'm looking at a black and white printout right now. I'll have to look at the actual photo again, but I can see what you're talking about, yeah.
Yeah. Now, wouldn't that be interesting?
But that doesn't mean anything either. I mean, back then, people, guys had long hair.
Right.
And they would put it up in a ponytail, actually, or in a little bun.
Right.
So,
Yeah. I'm just fascinated with these images. And the owl is there for a reason, too, as well. And there's so much symbolism with owls and different, not only religions, but just throughout history, what the owl symbolizes.
If this is the baptism of wisdom, then that's what that symbolizes. It's the owl of Minerva or Lilith. Owls have always been symbols of wisdom. The scene going on here reminded me of a scene in The Shining, and just because of the look on the owl's face. Do you remember in The Shining when, Jack Nicholson is... it's the little boy. He's running around trying to escape from his father, and he keeps running into different scary scenes in the rooms.
Yes.
And one of the scenes, there's like a guy dressed up like, a bear or something, and it looks like the guy in the bear costume, and then there's a couple of other guys. They're having an orgy together in one of the rooms.
Yep.
You remember this scene?
Yes.
He walks in on it, and they look at the camera. They look at the viewer in this menacing way, and look what you just walked in on. That's what it looks like, the look on that owl's face. And also the guy, one of the guys that's holding the dude in the cauldron, also looking at the viewer in the same manner.
Looking straight at you, right in your eyeballs. Yeah. Fascinating. Absolutely fascinating. What a conversation tonight. So now Friday night is Friday the 13th, and you're going to be on with me over at Coast to talk about, what Friday the 13th is, both in a modern context and, going back to October 13th with the Knights Templar. I want you to give a little teaser for Coast to Coast. In that, have we taken Friday the 13th completely out of context? And have we just turned it around into something that it wasn't? And what did Friday the 13th mean, so many years ago? And the original feelings amongst, the status quo, what Friday the 13th meant to them?
Well, it seems like it's a superstition that has been attached to the day, possibly simply because it was on that day that the Templars were arrested. And it could be that there's so many occult groups that you know, trace their origin to the Templars. They those groups may have been responsible, I think, for fostering this tradition that Friday the 13th is unlucky because of what happened to the poor Templars on that day. And then Hammer Perkstall actually has a theory about why they were arrested on that day. He thinks that Philip the Fair, the French king, may have chosen that day on purpose because he says that Friday was a sacred day to the Ophites and some of these other groups that that the Templars, he thinks, got their traditions from. So he's literally saying that the king of France knew what their traditions were, and he was trying to, you know, use that symbolism against them. So arrest them on Friday, their sacred day. And also the number 13, certainly after the Templars, took on a meaning associated with magic, associated with alchemy, and associated with the skull and crossbones, which is a symbol of the Baphomet head. The Templars used that symbol, and afterwards other groups used it. But to the Templars, it symbolized the Baphomet head, it seems to me. And afterwards, pirates, for instance, would sometimes have the skull and crossbones on their Jolly Roger flag, and sometimes they would put the number 13 underneath it. So for whatever reason, and you know, I can come up with some reasons, the number 13 seems like it might have been sacred to them, and it might have been associated with Baphomet specifically. So that may have been the reason why Philip chose to arrest them on that day.
Did Philip know that it was the 13th?
Did he know what day it was that he ordered them to be arrested?
Yeah, did he know it was Friday the 13th? He may have known it was Friday, but do you think that he knew it was Friday the 13th? And by the way, Philip the Fair, kind of a misnomer. You know, he was like the gnarliest king in history. mean, that's the other.
Okay.
You know, you go and you read about Philip the Fair, and he was exactly the opposite of that. You know, it's just kind of funny. You must laugh every time you read Philip the Fair. I mean, that dude was gnarly, you know.
I don't know. I've saw some pictures that were okay, but I've seen different pictures, totally drastically different depictions of him. So maybe the nicer ones were, you know, especially commissioned by him to make him look good.
Well,
to me.
Yeah. He was such a nasty dude that I think he must have, you know, everybody must call me Fair. Everybody must paint me looking nice. You know, it's just funny because he was anything but fair. So,
he scheduled this thing ahead of time, and everyone knew, all the people that worked for him knew exactly what day and time they were supposed to execute this arrest. And in fact, that's the theory about why so many of the Templars sort of got out of town before they were arrested, is because it had been sort of announced ahead of time, and they probably got some inside word on what was going to happen. So the choosing of the date and time, I think, was definitely deliberate and specific. And so if there's some symbolism to it, that has got to be part of the plan as well.
Tammy wants me to ask about the seal ring and the kissing of the seal ring. Is that where these traditions started too as well?
The kissing of the seal ring. I mean, the Pope, you know, people are supposed to kiss the Pope's ring.
Right.
I'm not sure what she's talking about exactly.
Okay. I think that is what she's referring to, the kissing of the ring,
is she asking, if the butt kissing is sort of a,
right,
bastardization of that, perhaps. I can see that.
Yeah, I can
but,
too.
I don't know.
Thank you so much, Tammy, and get some rest. We'll see you a couple of days on coast, and until then, keep doing it. And the new book is called Baphomet, The Mystery of Mysteries Unveiled. You can go to TracyTwyman.com. Tracy, be safe out there, and I'll talk to you in a couple of nights over on Coast to Coast.
All right. Thank you so much, Jimmy.
Thank you, Tracy.
Bye.
I warned you at the beginning of the show. Now, go to TracyTwyman.com. When you go to the homepage, I'm letting everybody know now, If you go to her homepage, you can scroll down right on the front of the homepage and go. It's called Found Again, the Templar Artifacts. It's you'll see the two pictures of the caskets there. The top one is the press release. Go click on the article right below that. Found Again, the Templar Artifacts of Hammer Purgstall. It's an incredible read, and these are excerpts from her new book, Baphomet, The Mysteries of Mysteries Unveiled. I'm going to take a quick break. I'll be back right after this, and more of news that you know nothing about. This is Fade to Black. Thank you, Tracy. Absolutely amazing, fascinating conversation. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. I'll be back right after this.
This is Fade to Black with Jimmy Church on the Game Changer Radio Network and KGRA, the Global Radio Alliance.
The station that talks the net, KGRA Radio.
Hello, I'm Hakimi, and you're listening to my main man, Jimmy Church, on jimmychurchradio.com.
Hi, this is Race Hobbs here, repping the planet, and you're listening to my good friend, Jimmy Church, Fade to Black, on the Game Changer Network and the KGRA Digital Broadcast Station.
Imagine no longer being tied down to your computer, but having the freedom to take live talk radio with you anywhere you go. TalkStream Live introduces our first ever iPhone application. The talk shows you follow now follow you. And your iPhone is now the fastest and easiest way to stay connected to the best talk radio on the internet. Let TalkStream Live transform the way you listen to radio. Listen to live talk shows 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Mobile talk radio from TalkStream Live. Now available in the iTunes App Store.
This is Toby Kebbell. You're listening to JimmyChurchRadio.com.
Don't hurt me, Jimmy. I'm only little.
Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And this is Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers. Yes. We are of the Honey Brothers. Hey, I'm Adrian Grenier.
And I'm Ari Gold.
We're the Honey Brothers.
And you're listening to Jimmy Church.
The Revolution.
All right, you fader not. Studio Dome has done it once again. A new Studio Dome Fader Not special. Introducing the Studio Dome Boom Box Bluetooth speaker. It's got a rear-firing bass film subwoofer and dual 52-millimeter main speakers. You'll never listen to your tablet or cell phone speakers again. Just click on the Studio Dome banner, use the promo code Jimmy, and you'll get the SBB for $49 and free shipping. And get a Buddy 4-port USB charger for free. That's a $19.99 value right there. And they'll throw in a Buddy in the box. It's the best deal on the net. Anywhere. Just go to jimmychurchradio.com, click on the Studio Dome banner, enter the promo code Jimmy, go Beckley Teppy.
This is Micah Hanks of the Graylian Report, and you're listening to Jimmy Church on Fade to Black, across the globe on the Game Changer Radio Network and the one and only KGRA Radio, the planet.
All right, welcome back, Fade to Black. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Thank you, Tracy Twyman. Fascinating conversation. The article is called Found Again, the Templar Artifacts of Hammer Purgstall. Just go to TracyTwyman.com. And there you can also order her new book, which is going to be released this Friday. Check this out. A survey of 250 oil train bridges across America found that almost half showed signs of considerable deterioration, including missing or crumbling concrete, partially washed away footings, rotting pilings, badly corroded steel beams. According to a report released today by the Waterkeeper Alliance, Riverkeeper, and Forest Ethics, the Federal Railroad Administration rarely inspects the nation's estimated 100,000 rail bridges, including some that were built more than 100 years ago. Instead, the agency leaves that responsibility to the railroads, which don't, by the way, make their inspection records public. That's right. Now, I talked about this last month, and here you go. And as you have probably noticed, you haven't been seeing these commercials on TV anymore. Coincidence? Well, the New York State Attorney General today ordered the two biggest daily fantasy sports companies, DraftKings and FanDuel, to stop accepting bets in New York, saying that their games constituted illegal gambling under state law. The cease and desist order came by the Attorney General Eric T. Schneiderman. It's a major blow to the multi-billion dollar industry that has introduced sports betting to legions of young sports fans and has formed partnerships with many of the nation's professional sports teams, giving the New York Attorney General's historic role as a consumer protection advocate. Legal experts now say the action will most likely reverberate to all of the other states where legislators and investigators are increasingly questioning whether the industry should operate unfettered by regulations that govern legalized gambling. Saw this coming. The strange thing is, look, I have no problems with Vegas. I have no problems with sports betting. I don't really care. But if you are going to have regulations that prevent online gambling, and I get that. I understand why. I do. I don't fully condone it, but then again, when you see this, you know, guys winning these $1 million checks, and you know, I bet $2 and I won $33,000 in a day. Whatever, it is gambling, and it's being advertised on television. And you see that, and you just wonder, how are these guys getting away with it? There's something that doesn't quite feel quite right with this. Well, it didn't last too long, did it? And I think FanDuel is fan over. Thank you, Tracy Twyman. Fascinating conversation. Come join Tracy and I this Friday night on Coast to Coast AM. Fade to Black's executive producer is Rita Carrara, and show is produced by Hilton J. Paul, Mark D. Kovar, LJ3, Renee, Mark Dunbar, and Jonas. Announcers are Steve Harder, Gene Vitoa, Mark D. Kovar. Special thanks to Dennis, Fady by Dale. Webmaster is Drew the Geek. Music, Doug Aldrich. Intro, Space Boy, spaceboymusic.com. Fade to Black is produced by KJCR for the Game Changer Network. Syndication is KGRA The Planet. Tomorrow night, right here, Michael Cremo. This broadcast is owned and copyrighted 2015 by Fade to Black and the Game Changer Network. It cannot be rebroadcast, downloaded, copied, or used anywhere in the known universe without written permission from Fade to Black or the Game Changer Network. I'm your host, Jimmy Church. Follow me on Twitter, at JChurchRadio. I want everybody to be safe. Go Beckley Tappy.